I just want to thank everybody for coming. And I really want to thank Bob for, you know, putting this on. You know, it's really important for us to be prepared. And I also did notice a bunch of criminals down in Manchester. I'll pick on Manchester again, because that's where they all come from now. But and they aren't happy that we're here to get educated. And that's the biggest thing, is to get educated on what you can do. And Bob's going to tell us everything that we can do to protect our homes, and especially outside our homes. I do want to thank the Senate up to the House. I'm a state representative, and the Senate did kill the repeal of Stand Your Ground. And I'm very happy with that, because I believe you have the right to protect your loved ones anywhere you are in this state. Matter of fact, I think you have the right anywhere you are in this country. So hopefully someday that law will also pass, which I understand it comes close every now and then, where your permit here will be good for the nation, which that's the way it should be. And again, I just want to thank everybody for being here, and I want to thank Bob. And thank you, Bob, for doing this for us.
You're welcome. Appreciate it.
All right, we're going to get started. The Refuse to Be a Victim program is, of course, an NRA program. It's not a gun program. It's not a personal, physical security. We're not going to teach you any hand-to-hand combat or anything like that tonight, so you can rest easy on that one. It is a crime prevention and personal safety program from the National Rifle Association. And I'm going to do some introductions here. My name is Bob Boilard. I am an NRA counselor, refuse to be a victim regional counselor, which means I certify instructors. And this seminar is actually a two-part series, the next part being the instructor development workshop on Sunday. And we should have a few instructor candidates in the room. I am an NRA speaker, NRA recruiter. As you can see, we have an information table over here. We have a display table. I'm also a USCCA affiliate instructor. I am a firearms instructor in 11 different disciplines. But again, I just want to remind you, this is not a firearms program. And I also do laundry, dishes, and vacuuming.
All right.
In your man card.
I do want to thank our sponsor, Representative Burt, for helping us put this together. I want to thank our sound guy, Steve Gamblin, who is a professional speaker, motivational speaker. He's an awesome stand-up comedian and just an all-around nice guy. So, Roger Boilard, my brother, who is on photography. Erin Campbell, who is the reception and gatekeeper out of the door. She's going to join us in about half an hour. She's waiting for the stragglers from 293. Skip Murphy is unfortunately not here. He was supposed to live stream this on Granite Rock tonight, but so far he's probably in that mess on 293. And of course, the Yard Seafood and Steakhouse for hosting us, and our instructor candidates. Who are they? Can you stand up so I can see you guys? All right, we got one, two, should be four, at least four of them in here. Awesome. All right, so again, I just want to thank everybody for helping us put this together. All right, getting started. The seminar will be interrupted at least every hour. NRA policy is a break every hour. That's regardless of this seminar, firearms classes, every class is standard policy is an hour, which works out pretty well because I am over 50. So feel free to ask any questions that you have during the seminar, okay? This is an interactive seminar. We want your input. In fact, a lot of times this presentation will actually change from input from you guys. You got a question? An extra pen.
Attack everything
but your pen. All right, hold on. I aim to please. We are army strong. All right. Again, this is not a self-defense or a firearms course. It's not intended to scare you, although some of the stats in this will probably be startling to you. But all the more reasons for you guys to pay attention to what's going on in your environment, your neighborhood, or wherever you are. I would ask you to be respectful of others speaking. Right? We don't want to get into any heated arguments or anything like that. During the break, I do suggest you visit the display table and the information table. And again, if you have any questions, let me know. I do suggest that you read the manual that everybody has, because this is only a 3-hour seminar. There's a lot more information in the manual. Okay, we just can't possibly cover everything in there tonight. All right, so what is Refuse to be a Victim? It's a nationally recognized crime prevention and personal safety program designed to provide men and women with the information to assist in the development of their own personal safety strategies. Developed by the NRA in 1993, it did go co-ed in 1997 because this information is just good for men and women to know. It is one of the NRA's general programs. It still is part of the women's programs. And again, it was developed by women of the NRA for women. So let's examine our day and mentally review where you are most vulnerable during your day. Is it at home? Is it in your car? Think about all the, every place that you go during the day and where you could become a victim of crime. Identify areas where you are most vulnerable, and then ask yourself, what does a criminal look like? Anybody know? Okay, Ted Kennedy. All right. Well, that's pretty much exactly right. Although, they can look like anybody. All right, and that's the thing, is that you just never know what they are. Okay, it would be a lot easier if they were a sign. Maybe you can come up with a bill so that all criminals need to wear a sign. That work?
Yes.
Yeah, unfortunately, criminals don't obey signs. And they probably won't wear them either.
Why not tattoo it right on the forehead?
Tattoo right on the forehead.
Yeah.
All right, that works for me.
Right.
So, they can be anybody that you don't know. They can be anybody that you do know. Okay. So you have to be careful of everybody that you come in contact with every day. So, common characteristics of criminals is obviously low self-esteem. They're extremely selfish, lack of conscience and self and sense of mercy. View niceness as weakness. They blend well into the community, so you really never know who you're dealing with. Constantly seeking criminal opportunity. They're always looking for an easy target and an easy opportunity to take advantage of you. And that's part of what this program is all about, is portraying yourself that you're not an easy target. Okay. Part of that is being prepared. Okay. And preparing, one level of it is being aware. Being aware of your environment, being aware of where you are. If you're in a coffee shop, being aware of who's around you. Okay. Observing people that are around you. Because a lot of times you can pick them out, right? So we have different levels of awareness. Okay, when you're home and in your living room watching a movie, right? You're probably at your lowest level of awareness, right? When you're out in the world, coffee shop, right? Your awareness level should be higher, right? And I see this all the time. I go into a coffee shop, people are on their cell phones, totally oblivious to everything that's going on around them, okay? And that's exactly what criminals look for. They look for opportunity where they can surprise you and to take advantage of you. So, a high level would be in an unknown area, probably a high crime area, or if you're taking a shortcut through an alley, don't do that. Not a good idea. So mental conditioning, developing a mental plan of action to use in the event you're confronted in certain situations, right? So that means having a plan ahead of time. Preparing your mind of what you're gonna do in certain situations, okay? This is the same tactic that SEAL teams, military, and many other SWAT teams, for example, use to their advantage, okay? And basically what it's doing is pre-programming your mind to react in a certain way in certain conditions. Right. If you don't do that, then you might have some reactions that you're just not aware that, you might freeze, which is really bad. Right. So we're going to go over some of that. And you also have to think of the ramifications and the outcome of your actions. Okay. If you overreact to certain situations, you can be arrested for if you take a pepper spray and you overreacted and you spray somebody with pepper spray where they really didn't need pepper spray, you could be arrested. So you really have to think about your actions before you do them. Okay? And part of that is preparing a plan. So when confronted with a potentially violent crime, natural reaction is to fight, flight, freeze, compliance, or posture. Fight or flight is always preferred, right? First thing that you want to do, first priority, is to get out of the situation, okay? Second, if you have no other choice, is to fight, okay? People who fight in a violent situation usually end up much better than people who do nothing. And I'll show you some statistics on that also. Freezing is a temporary condition caused by fear, and we're going to go over how to control fear. And we must control our conditioning, our mind, to respond to with the correct action that we want it to. The other thing to fear is fear itself. Everybody's heard this, right? And that's true. Fear can get you killed. It's used in the animal kingdom, where some animals, that's their only defense, is they freeze, pretend they're dead, right? You don't want to do that. And that's the last option that you want to do. So we're going to talk a little bit about fear and how to control it. Fear is a negative emotional response to the perception that you cannot control the outcome of an unanticipated or sudden dangerous situation. Okay? Your mind just basically freezes. It doesn't know what to tell you to do. In a lot of these situations, it's your subconscious mind that takes over so that you react the way it wants you to, because in a violent situation, your conscious mind is really out to lunch. Right? Instead of just believing in your right to be safe, you must believe in your ability to protect yourself. That's, that's number one. And that comes down to, we'll talk a little bit about that also. Factors that influence how susceptible you are to fear. One is your perception. How do you see and interpret danger? Second is your power. How you see yourself in relationship to your adversary. All right, so if someone comes up to you and they're only 3 feet tall, let's say they're gonna beat the living daylights out of you, well, you're not really gonna take them seriously, right? However, if they're 6'9", you might take that threat a little more seriously. Again, you're training. How well equipped are you to deal with the situation? And we're going to go over personal protection devices tonight. Your attitude, seeing yourself as a winner. You have to say, I am going to control this situation, I'm a winner, and I'm going to take over. Okay? And develop a never give up attitude. Your control. How many options do you have to control the outcome? Okay? Be it a stun gun, a knife, a gun, whatever it is. Right? How many things in your toolbox do you have to control the situation? So the best way to control fear is to, one, change your perception of danger. And that, again, you do that through mental preparedness. Increase your power through self-awareness, self-esteem, and self-image. Right? Seeing yourself as that winner. I will win. I will prevail, no matter what. Increase your skills. Increase your ability. Increase your health. Okay? That may be training. Physical training, firearms training, whatever that may be. Okay? Again, this seminar is designed so that you can develop the plan that that fits with your life. Okay? Transform fear into anger. Right? Instead of, you know, freezing up, saying, no way, you don't have the right to make me a victim. So reverse it on them. The use of positive thought conditioning. Again, seeing yourself as their winner. You must allow your training, your conditioning, and skills to service so that you perform with a conditioned response in times of crisis. All right, so understanding the fight or flight, there are many things that happens in a high-stress situation, and many things like your ears will shut off, right? Your adrenaline is pumping, so you have a higher pain threshold. There's all kinds of things that happens to you under high stress. And those are some of the things that we're trying to control with thought conditioning, training, and, you know, just increasing your health. Maybe that's, you know, just even better. Whatever it is for you, that's what. Yeah.
Also, if you have tunnel vision, then you go from color to black and white.
Yes. There's all kinds of changes that go on, and, you know, you do want to try to control those as much as possible. All right. So developing a personal protection plan. At its most basic level, a personal protection plan is designed to help keep us physically, legally, financially, and morally safe. Does that make sense to anybody? Any thoughts on what that means? All right. One, obviously we want to protect our bodies, but we also want to protect our financials, okay? If you overreact to a situation and you're brought up on criminal charges, right? Let's say, you know, you used your gun and you shot somebody, and, you know, that could be very expensive. That is enough to devastate a family as far as legal fees and everything else. And you could lose your house, you could lose everything just to pay for the lawyer to protect you. Right? So you have to act in a way that's prudent. Right? And, you know, again, these are all things that you have to think about ahead of time. Morally, right? Can you deal with taking action against someone and potentially harming them? Right. And again, you know, there have been times where people have shot, you know, a 17-year-old kid in their house and could not live with the fact that he took the life of a 17-year-old kid and committed suicide. So you have to, you know, you really do have to plan these things out ahead of time so that you do stay safe, not just your physical body, but your health and your financials, legally and morally, right? Because again, it's not just you. You know, I'm sure many of you have families, wives, husbands, and you have to protect them also. So while our personal protection plan should include becoming proficient with firearm or some other defensive tool, whatever it is you choose, our ultimate goal should always to be avoid violent encounters in the first place. By developing an acute awareness of our surroundings and by making intelligent decisions about our actions and behavior. And this is true. The only guaranteed method of surviving a violent encounter is to avoid it in the first place. Right? And the avoiding is long before you get into the situation. It's right down to how you carry yourself. Carrying yourself like a victim will probably make you a victim. If you carry yourself, you don't talk. If you carry yourself like you're in command, like you have a purpose, like you know you're not gonna mess with me, then you probably won't become a victim because you don't look like an easy target. So is your home a safe place? Good question, huh? All right. Facts. 80% of sexual assaults take place in the victim's homes and by people you know. Okay, not you might not know them very well, but you may know them as an acquaintance. Somebody you hired to mow the lawn at one point, but you're acquainted most of the time with these people. Anybody know the time of day that is most prevalent? Early morning, between 6 and 9 a.m. after Dad goes to work, is the most prevalent time. Another thing you have to understand is that police have no obligation to protect you. Okay? The Supreme Court has ruled many times that their obligation is to protect society as a whole, not you as an individual. Okay, so in many cities like Detroit, Illinois, whatever, you know, the bigger cities, 50% of 911 calls are never responded to. Unless you're bleeding or dying, sometimes you won't get help, right? So that tells you that you are in charge of your own personal safety. You are your first responder, your family's first responder. So you have to, you know, take the responsibility and develop a plan ahead of time. And according to the U.S. Department of Justice, if you are home when a criminal gains entry to your house, then there's a 1 in 3 chance of becoming a victim of violence. That's pretty high. And we're going to go over some stats, a little more stats here. Violent crime versus other, you are 3 times more likely to be a victim of a violent crime than you are a home fire. That's huge. You know? And I have stats on Manchester later during the seminar, which will probably surprise you also. If you are 58 more times as likely to be assaulted than you are injured in a home fire, again, that's huge, all right? So where everybody is worried about, you know, having their fire alarms, and they should be also worried about people breaking into your home and your personal security. So, let's talk about your home. Garage doors. What's this kind of garage door? What's the best kind of garage door? The best kind. All right. One that's closed, actually. Right? And I see this all the time. I go down the street, the garage doors are open, family's out back in the pool, and you have to realize that criminals are brazen, all right? They will go into your house while you are home, all right? So, keep your garage doors closed. Keep your doors locked, even when you're home. Keep your alarm set when you're home, especially at night, all right? Always a good idea. Sliding glass doors. I have seen sliding glass doors put on backwards, where all you had to do was
pull the door
up and take it right off the slide. In fact, I had a contractor that put a sliding door in my house and put it on backwards. So, again, check your doors. Pet doors come in all different sizes, right? Pet doors is a good place for criminals to either unlock the door or get in, you know, if you have a very large dog. Pet doors are probably not recommended, okay? And if you have one, I would, you know, and it is large enough to get through, I would recommend replacing the door. You'll just have to open the door for Fido when he wants to go out. Door viewers, you know, the little peepholes, always a good idea to have, but let me introduce you to a little peephole's big brother. Right, this is a door scope, all right? And with this one, you can stand about 4 feet behind it and see everything that's out there. And they can't use a reverse door viewer on this one. which is, I don't have one here, but a door viewer is, you go up to the door, like a hotel room door or whatever it is, and it reverses the peephole so that you can see into the room. Alright, so. All kinds of manufacturers make this. This is actually just a plastic one. I'll pass this around so you can see it. But. Good suggestion, especially in hotel rooms.
She went, oh my God.
Yes, they sell, in fact, I have a picture of one coming up, a door viewer for $40, and it reverses the actual peepholes so that instead of you looking at them, they can look at you. All right. Cellar doors and windows, always make sure those, if you have an alarm system in your house, always make sure that the cellar doors are alarmed. Cellar windows are alarmed because they are large enough for criminals to get through. And it's the one thing that alarm companies always forget. You know, it's why? Check your doors, make sure that your hinges are on the inside of the house. I've seen this before, where the door or the casement was on backwards, and all you had to do was, you know, pull the hinges on. So.
Double dead
bolts, yeah, we're going to go over those too. Keep your doors and your garage doors locked even when you're home, okay? So, types of locks. There are chain locks, bar locks, cylinder, single cylinder, double cylinder. Excuse me?
I just have a comment on the garage doors. If you have the garage door opener, you need to keep your car locked in the driveway because they can open it by getting in the car and pushing the button.
Good point. Did everybody hear that? It says keep your car in the garage so that they can't use the garage door opener to open the garage doors. And my daughter does it all the time. She keeps the car in the garage. All I can do is press the button in the door.
Right.
So kind of locks is you know, all kinds of different types of locks, single cylinder, double cylinder, deadbolts. Right? You want them 1 inch to the wall, so when you do turn that deadbolt, it goes into the door at least an inch. Okay? And because the number one way of criminals getting into the home is a single kick to the door. So, how many people have bought a house and never had their locks changed? The realtor hands you the keys, you go home, you make all kinds of copies of your keys and you hand them to the kids. And how many people used to own that home, how many keys did they make for their house? And how many people have access to your house now? All right, so if you do buy a new home, first thing you want to do is rekey all the locks. Okay?
And get rid of the quick set.
Get rid of what?
Get rid of them all together if they're quick set locks.
Get rid of them all together if they're quick set locks, yes. And keep mindful of your key storage. All right? Don't hide a key outside, underneath the rock or something like that. You know, and people still do this. You know, the best place to keep a spare key for your house is a trusted neighbor. All right? A trusted neighbor, I said. So a double cylinder lock will actually have a key on both sides. All right? Now, a single cylinder will have this on one side and will have this on the other. No, they both have different purposes. Yeah.
Fire departments tend not to like double cylinder locks.
Fire departments don't like what locks?
Double cylinder.
I'm sorry.
You can't find a key in the case of the fire.
Yes. We're going to go over that. Yes.
They don't protect
it. Right. Problem is with a situation like this, right, where you have a window right there, a single cylinder deadbolt is very easy to break that window and just flip the door open. Okay? A double cylinder lock with a key on both sides, even if they break this window, they can't gain access to the house. Okay? Yeah, fire departments don't like that, but I think you're just gonna have to get over it. Right? Good thing to do is to keep that key within reach of the door, all right? Put it, you know, hang it on the wall or hang it under, you know, put it underneath something that everybody in the house knows where it is, all right? So they can get out when they need to, all right? Yeah, I know fire departments don't like it, but again, they don't worry about your personal safety. They, you know, they're going to break it down anyway, so.
Bob?
Yeah.
You know, it's ironic that they don't like the keys. You know, they don't want to kick your door in, but they'll cut a hole in your roof.
Yeah. That too. So a single cylinder deadbolt would be in a situation like this, where you have no windows, you can't, you know, you're not going to break through the stonework there. So that is perfectly acceptable in that door, okay? And it'll make the fire department happy. So the other option is just getting rid of your windows. You know, is boarding those windows up and having a contractor take care of those windows. Also, if you have a window in the door, the same situation. You want a double cylinder lock for that door. Yes, all your outside doors should be a solid wood door or a metal door. Okay, you don't want any of this, you know, balsa wood stuff that they put in the house. And you really do have to check, because these contractors are just, you know, they try to skimp at every phase of their, you know, building a house. They're trying to make money, so you really do have to check them all the time. All right. So types of windows. And window locks, this is not a lock, right? This can be easily tampered with and opened. This is actually a lock, right? Again, it's another small thing that you can do. You can go down to Home Depot and buy these and install them yourself, right? Another option for windows is window stops, right, which can come in all different shapes, sizes. I've seen some that are suction cups that go right on the window to prevent it from opening. And these can be adjusted. You want to open the window a little bit for ventilation or completely closed. Right? You don't want to open the window for ventilation any more than probably about 6-7 inches at the most. Okay. Casement windows. Boy, you'd be surprised what I can do with one of these. Those windows will open right up with one of these. All right, so you want to make sure that your casement windows, kind that you actually have to crank open, are secure. And again, you can use, there's all kinds of different things. Go into Home Depot and, you know, tell them I have a casement window. I need some way to secure it from it opening all the way. All right, they have little arms that basically open with it, and only allows it to open so far. Also, reinforcing the hinges on casement windows are an excellent idea. One thing I missed here is the armor glass film. Right, armor glass film is the same film that hotels use for hurricane prevention. Right, so once that film goes on, I mean, you can try to throw a 2x4 through that window, and it's not going to go through. All right, it's a little pricey. Armor glass film is probably about $6.50 a square foot, but it's great for, you know, especially sliding glass doors where, you know, throwing a patio chair through the window would be nice and easy. Well, that film would prevent that from happening. Interior lighting. All right, so you want to make a study of what your family does when you turn lights on, when you turn them off, so that if you do go on vacation, you can program timers. And I have a few sample timers over here. This one is actually a six-phase timer where you can actually program six different times of the day. You buy a couple of these and program them while you're on vacation, and makes it look like your home almost. Exterior lighting is number one. Okay, that's another layer of protection that you have in your arsenal. Right, and this is what we're trying to do, is we're trying to build layers of protection within your home. Okay, each layer may be giving you a second or two you know, advance notice or time to react to a situation. Okay? Exterior lighting, criminals do not like lighting. Okay? If they're walking through your yard and you have a motion sensor and a light comes on, yeah, that freaks them out. All right? So, another, you know, inexpensive option, make sure that you have lights on all four sides of your house. All right? I do highly recommend motion sensors because they will come on without, you know, you throwing a switch. Motion sensors are a little more expensive, but they really come down. Right? I mean, they're very affordable and they can save your life. Right? So having that lighting outside is good. Pathway lighting is also a good idea, even if it's not motion sensor. It's just, you know, personal safety, so you don't trip or someone doesn't trip on your driveway or whatever. Shrubbery outside your house, keeping your shrubbery low so that it doesn't give criminals a place to hide from, you know, passing cars, or keeping those low and away from the house. Also, if you want to do defensive ones that have the spikes and the thorns, right? They don't like that either. Bayberry, roses, multiflora, thistle, gooseberry are all, you know, good options for the front of your house. And again, keep it trimmed, right? Make sure that criminals don't have a place to hide in your house. Again, you know, go through your yard and check to make sure that every place, you know, you don't have ladders outside so that they can gain access to the second floor, right? Because most alarm systems are only first floor. So if you leave a ladder outside in the yard, well, you know, they can go right upstairs and bypass the alarm system. And we're going to talk a little bit about alarms. All right. Alarms, again, are a good option for early detection, okay? Silent alarms are not for homes. Silent alarms are for businesses, right? So you don't want a silent alarm. Having a perimeter alarm. There's, you know, I've got some inexpensive options here of drive, you know, this is a driveway alarm right here. And again, during the break, you guys can check these out. Again, these are battery powered, so you have to be diligent in changing the batteries. Okay? There are more expensive options. Okay, but you know, everybody wants to do this and not break the bank. So a driveway alarm will basically make a chime in your house when someone's driving down your driveway. So, John?
Bob, I use those in my shed. And then that way I figured if somebody goes in my shed, then it's up in my bedroom.
Good idea. Another good use for them, yeah.
And yep. From my bedroom window, I got a straight shot down.
Yep.
So they aren't coming out.
Nice. Another good option, right? So there's a few different types of personal alarms up here, and there's all kinds of them, and they really do come in handy because, I mean, they're an early warning system for you. So make sure that your alarm company is covering your basement. Again, those cellar doors and those cellar windows are very important, because they're right there at ground level and they're easy to break. And most alarm companies forget them. So make sure your basement windows are covered. Older alarms. How many people have an ADT alarm in their house? Got it for $299, free installation. Only charge you $40 a month for monitoring. Okay? Problem with these alarms, a lot of these older ones are not a two-part system. All right. You have usually 15 seconds to get into your house and deactivate the alarm. All right. Well, that gives the criminal 15 seconds to get into your house, get the keypad, rip it off the wall, cut the wire, and destroy the alarm. All right. Because most of those alarms are all in one unit. They have the dialer, they have the alarm, they have the entire brain is in that one thing that's on the wall next to your door. All right. So you definitely want a good alarm. Yeah.
Another thing that occurs on the ADT thing, if you see their ad, and I think it's their ad, they show a phone call into the house. saying, are you okay? And if the person says no, then they say, well, okay, I'll call the police and have them come. Doesn't sound like much protection to me.
Yeah, they usually have a code, okay, that you have to give to the monitor. All right, when they call, you have a code that you have to give them. And if you don't say the correct code, then they will call the police automatically. All right, because, yeah, criminals might answer the phone.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
The other problem with ADT, in particular, all calls go through Denver.
Really?
And then they're transferred out. If there's a problem, they're transferred out to your local area. So that takes time.
Did you used to sell ADT?
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
Another thing is, if you put a little sticker, this house protected by ADT,
yep.
You're telling the burglars how to defeat it. You
sure.
Get a generic sticker that just says, this house protected by alarm.
Yep, yep.
Yeah, although those stickers are good, but putting the name of the company, so, yeah. And, you know, some of these criminals are smart. I mean, they know the different types of alarms, especially if they're career criminals and they know what their alarms are about, okay? They're easy to disable. So make sure you get a two-part system if you do have a new alarm put in, or, yeah?
Yeah, so can you recommend an alarm company?
I have one right on the information table.
Okay.
And it's a local company. They don't kill you as far as monitoring. It's $9.95 a month. Versus $40 a month, okay? Good friend of mine, and highly recommend him. He does my house. So alarms, you want a two-part system where the entire brain of the system isn't next to your door, all right? The dialer and the actual brain is usually installed in the downstairs, the cellar, or somewhere, in a closet or whatever, right? They have new ones now where you don't even need a phone line, it's all radio. Okay, so when they can cut your landline, cut your phone lines, and it's still going to allow, the monitoring company to be alerted. Now, keep in mind that Manchester does have a fire alarm permit fee, whatever it is, which is $25, so. Yeah, they do, yeah.
Do they? Goffstown has no charge.
Yeah. Well, there shouldn't be any charge.
Right, Goffstown's no charge. So move to Goffstown.
Yeah. Yeah. So, again, alarm monitoring companies, they all come in different shapes and sizes, but most of them are usually three major monitoring companies. And always remember to reset your codes. All right? I see a lot of people who, give the carpet cleaner the code to the house so that they can clean the carpets while they're at work. Change the code afterwards would be a good idea. All right, so change your codes frequently. Even on access, okay, on the door locks that actually have a combination, change your codes on a regular basis. All right, so according to the FBI statistics, burglars enter the front door of homes 34% of the time and the back doors 22% of the time. The most common method of breaching the door is a good swift kick. Easy enough. All right. So adding a reinforced strike plate like this and mounting your strike plate with 3-inch screws that are actually going to go into the studding of the house, okay, not just in that cheap pine board that's surrounding your casing, okay? This is a 3-inch screw versus probably half of that comes with the actual locks that you buy, okay? So there's a huge difference there, and getting this out of a 2x4 studding versus a piece of pine board is much more difficult. That can buy you a lot of time, all right, to get into your safe room. Get frequently prepared. FBI statistics also show that the first floor windows are the next favorite entry point at 23%. So again, securing your windows. Sometimes just putting knickknacks on the windowsill is, either they have to push those off to make, and it's going to make noise, or they have to take the time and actually remove anything that you have on the windowsill, all right? again buying you time, valuable time that, that you may need. Also adding a stop bar that we discussed earlier, and the armor glass, hey, it was 660 per foot. And there are a few companies around that, that do this. Yeah.
That armor glass, is that got self-adhesive on it and just fit over the exterior?
Yeah, it's heat-treated, though. It's not just, you know, peel and stick. It's heat-treated. I don't know. I've never put it on, so.
they actually have, because that's what I have at my house, the ballistic film you can buy.
Yeah.
It's dirt cheap, and it is just thick and put on.
Oh, great. Did everybody hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, if you want to, either you have my card, email me what that film is, because I'll actually incorporate that into the program. All right, so home alarms, insurance company surveys. Sound like a game show host. 60 to 81% of people who have burglar alarms fail to set them at home or even when on vacation. That is so true. And, you know, you spend all this money for an alarm system, use it. Number one excuse, 53% for failing to set their alarms is because the homeowner leaves pets indoors because they have motion sensors inside, okay? And most alarm systems, you know, have an away thing, and they have a stay button, right? If you hit the stay button, then those motion detectors are disabled, okay? So that's really not an excuse, is it? Right? And also, manufacturers now have pet immune motion detectors. So you can change those motion detectors out and put ones that don't pick up pets. Homes that have alarms are 3 times less likely to be burglarized. Again, that's a huge, huge thing in your arsenal to know, okay? And putting that sign out front of your house that says protected by, well, get one that doesn't say ADT. All right, protected by an alarm system, which they really don't know. And that's a huge deterrent. In fact, I suggest even if you don't have an alarm system, get one of those signs. Because deception is your friend, all right? Criminals don't know that you're lying, right? You know, same thing with this. If you don't have a dog, how do they know? Put a sign up. Oh, that's right. Criminals don't read signs. They will read that sign, trust me. Yeah, I have seen those. They do have motion sensors that have a recording of, you know, like a German Shepherd or something like that. I haven't really heard any of them to see how well, you know, how real life they are, or if you can tell if it's a recording or what.
You can piss off their neighbors too,
I guess. Yeah, it might piss off the neighbors, yeah.
Bob, yeah. Could we have a recording of a...
That is one pretty good turn, isn't it? That is a universal language. Everybody knows that sound. Oh, sure. All right, home security. Get a dog. What does everybody think about that?
My dog will help you love the TV.
All right. Dogs are great early warning systems. They really are. All right. But I don't suggest that you go out and buy a dog just for home security. Okay? Go out and buy a dog because you love dogs. Not any other reason. All right. Again, they are a great early warning system. They will tell you long before probably any of the electronic devices do. Okay? They're that attuned to what's going on. The negatives is obviously care and training. Right? My vet bills are like ridiculous. I think he gets more manicured better than I do. So, liability and insurance. Your dog gets loose and bites somebody. That's a problem. And vacation. They're never around when you're on vacation. They're either at the kennel or staying with a friend. Okay. So they're really no help when you're on vacation. Again, what size is best? It really doesn't matter. That's personal choice, and because all dogs have a pretty good, you know, early warning system for you. And again, the full the criminal techniques, deception is your friend. If you don't have a dog, you don't want a dog, buy a sign. All right, keys, separating your keys. How many times have you gone to bring your car in and you've given your keys? The whole thing. Got your house keys on it, got, you know, everything, your lock box or whatever. And you just give it to the mechanic who knows where you live, because you give him your address. Okay, or the valet. Well, the valets don't know where you live, but you know, your mechanic knows where you live. Very easy to make a quick copy of these keys. Just sometimes use something as simple as Play-Doh. Okay. So get yourself, you know, separate your keys and make sure that you only give them the keys that they need. Yeah?
Just to amplify that, 2 weeks ago, I took my car and separated the key, gave them the key. They stole my GPS. So,
yeah.
Think of anything, huh?
Yeah, that's true. Did you check Craigslist? No, I'm serious. A friend of mine actually, his car got broken into. They stole his GPS, they stole his camera, they stole his iPod, all that. He went on Craigslist, and there's all his stuff for sale. So we ended up calling the guy, saying, "Hey, I'm interested in all this stuff." And we actually met him in the parking lot at Shaw's on South Willow Street. Except it wasn't us that met him, it was the cops. And sure enough, they found him with all the stolen, not just his, but many others. Yeah. So yeah, it was in the Union Leader. So what do you do with spare keys? Don't hide them in your car. Don't put them outside in the lawn or whatever. Again, you know, leave it with a trusted friend, a trusted neighbor, or whoever, all right? Just want to make sure that you don't actually hand the keys over to whoever wants to, you know, steal your stuff, all right? Children and keys, that's a big one, all right? So you're at work all day, your kids come home at, you know, 3 o'clock or so, they have a key for the house. Be very diligent about, you know, instructing your kids so that they know nobody has access to these keys. You got to basically sit them down and tell them that, you know, you don't lend these keys to anybody. Nobody goes in the house without, you know, our approval, that kind of thing. Because that's a huge thing. If, you know, if criminals know that the kids have keys, they'll try to steal them. And it's been done many times. All right, visitors. Wide-angle door viewers. I just passed one around. That is a great option. Also, remember, if you have handicapped in the house, good idea is put one lower. Okay, so they can see too, because, you know, a lot of people forget that. Anybody who comes to your door, you always want to confirm identification, and don't take their word for it. Okay? This guy right here, he dressed up like UPS drivers and everything else. Everybody know who this is? Ted Bundy. Yeah, he was a very charismatic serial killer. He could talk his way into more houses than you'd ever want to know. He killed over 30 women. And, well, now they're saying probably more than that, but he confessed to about 30 of them. And anywhere from Florida up to Colorado, he was all over the place. And he looked like everybody else, he talked like everybody else. He was very charismatic, so you really do have to be careful. Having an intercom on your door, not a bad idea if you can afford it. Okay. there are inexpensive options that work, that you don't have to break the bank to do it. Right? Never tell a visitor you're alone. Entry ploys, you know, they have tried everything. They have tried little kids. You know, saying, "My mommy's up the street, she had an accident," and they prey on your sympathy. "Oh yeah, come on in, sweetheart." And as soon as you open that door, you've got two guys busting through, okay? They will try anything, so you have to be careful. Again, this is New Hampshire, all right, not Detroit or Illinois. So, you know, people are more relaxed about this kind of stuff, but it does happen. You know, Kimberly Case, perfect example. So, again, remember that 80% of sexual assaults are by people known to the victim. And rape is not a victim, is not a sex act, okay? It is an act of violence. It doesn't matter your personal appearance, right? It can be a 20-year-old, it can be a 14-year-old, it can be an 80-year-old, all right? So, in all aspects, you have to be careful. Again, misinformation and deception is your friend. If you're home alone, my husband is in the shower, can you come back later? Something on that idea, okay? Your German Shepherd idea, okay? If they really sound real, use it. Okay, deception is your friend. It will keep you alive. Yeah.
My aunt lived alone in Kentucky in a big old farmhouse. She always had a pair of size 12 work boots on the back porch.
Good idea. Right? So these are all. That's why we have this. That's why this seminar is interactive, because we love to hear from other ideas from you guys, and a lot of that ends up in these presentations. Yeah.
How about instead, my husband is cleaning his gun.
I like that, yeah. That works for me. All right, mailboxes. Let's talk a little bit about mailboxes. All right, so, you know, identity theft is really big right now. And you're out at work all day, and your mailbox sits in the mailbox until you get home. Okay, perfect place for criminals to get information about you. Right. So what I suggest, in lieu of that, is to use either personal mailbox service, or like UPS, or they have lock boxes there. Post office box.
Hello.
Post office box is another. Those are actually pretty cheap. You know, they're like $60 a year for a post office box. They are inconvenient because you do have to go to the post office to get your mail. Another option is a keyed mailbox. Okay, if you don't want to go get your mail somewhere else, the mailbox that you have in front of your house, put a key on it. Okay, they sell keyed mailboxes so that your mail is not sitting in the box all day. Okay. Mail slot works. Yeah. But if you can get the post guy to get out of the truck and walk up to the house, good luck. Well, if they do it on a regular basis anyways, then, that's fine. But, like at my house, I know he's not getting out of the truck. So, you're not going to get your mail. All right, so home security, defense, and safe rooms. Safe rooms. All right, the safe room is your last line of defense. All right, so we're going to talk a little bit about safe rooms and everything that you should have in there. All right, a safe room is a room in your house that you designate as your sanctuary. If someone breaks into your house, this is where you're going to barricade yourself into, all right? So you need certain tools in that room to help you, all right? One is a cell phone, because landlines can be cut very easily, okay, outside. Even if it's an old cell phone, okay, that is not enabled anymore. This cell phone isn't activated, but if I turn it on and dial 911, guess what? Cops are showing up, okay, in New Hampshire. If this was Detroit, they would show up. Cell phones can always dial 911, so keep an old cell phone in your safe room on the charger. Okay, perfect. All right, flashlights and extra batteries. Always a good idea to have a flashlight, and I mean a flashlight. Don't buy a cheap one. Okay, there are flashlights, and then there are flashlights, all right? This is a tactical flashlight. It's about $65, and it will really light up a room, okay? Home and automobile keys. Bringing your car keys to bed. What did I do? I'm walking home.
All right.
That little remote right there with the alarm system on my truck. Okay, if I press this, most likely my alarm will go off. All right, same thing in your house. All right, the alarm will go off in your driveway, or you know, whether it's in your garage or whatever, it's still going to make noise. All right, criminals do not like the fact that you now have brought attention to the situation. All right, a lot of times that will make them flee right there. Okay, just knowing that you know they're in the house will probably make them take off. All right. So, you're going to have your protection devices, whatever it is you decide as a protection device, whether it's pepper spray, fire extinguishers. I've seen people use fire extinguishers for personal protection, you know, in safe rooms, a firearm or whatever it is, okay? A ladder, right? Now, I'm not saying to try to send grandma down this ladder, okay? Right? This is a good idea in case of fire, okay? You shouldn't have to, you know, come down a ladder like this for a criminal entry, right? Unless it's a last resort, okay? If you don't have a firearm in your house, and let's say they, you know, stop the door on fire, right? Well, you know, you still want to stay alive, so that would be your last option, your last hour. Okay? Get out of the house, okay? No.
Question regarding Massachusetts. To my understanding that even if you have a firearm and you're in your safe room, that they still expect you to depart the premises under any circumstances before you use lethal force. So you have to be completely trapped without any possible means of egress.
Well, even the NRA teaches that a firearm is a tool of last resort when all other options are not an option. Okay, so, but concerning Massachusetts does not want you to protect yourself, okay? Just about everything on this table, you know, the batons, the stun guns, the mace, all that are illegal in Massachusetts. The pepper spray, basically you buy an $8 piece of pepper spray and you have to spend $100 to carry it or to own it. That's the, you know, the fact in Massachusetts. They do not want you to protect yourself, period. So they, you know, they feel that they have a police force that is designed to protect you, where, you know, the Supreme Court has stated over and over again that's not their job. Okay? Your personal security is your job. Yeah, I think somebody else mentioned that too. All right, I'm not getting into politics tonight because this seminar will take a whole curve. We'll take a curve. Yeah, somebody else had a question? I'm getting the watch thing. Yes. Okay, we're going to take a break.
One quick
and we'll continue on after.
One quick thing.
All right?
You show a bunch of fire extinguishers there.
Yep.
Who's everybody to have for every entrance way into the house or in your bedroom so you can fight your way out? At least a 25-pound fire extinguisher if you can pick it up, because a 3 to 5 pound fire extinguisher lasts less than 30 seconds.
Yep.
So, I mean, if you got to get your out of the house and you got double deadlock doors,
yep,
you got to be able to get out. A 25-pounder is what you need.
All right, everybody hear that? All right, everybody should have a 25-pound fire extinguisher near every door. Right, because the smaller ones just don't last long. All right, we're going to take a short break, about 10 minutes, and then we'll continue on. All right, so we're going to get going again. Any questions up to this point?
Can you compare bear spray with mace?
Yeah, we're going to go over mace, pepper spray, all that good stuff. When we get to the personal protection. All right, so in your safe room, you should have, at least try to have all of this stuff. Develop a plan that in your house so that if something does happen, the alarm goes off or whatever, that everybody in the house knows what the plan is, all right? And you really have to look at the layout of your home and to see where the best place to have your safe room is, all right?
Why a glow stick?
A glow stick is so that when you dial 911 and the police arrive, and you're up on the second floor, and you throw your keys down to the police so they don't have to crash your door open, right? You can attach the glow stick to your keys so they don't have to go looking for it in the grass. Okay? It's a very easy way for them to find it right away and saves valuable time. Cheap flashlight, okay. I would recommend a better flashlight because once it hits the ground, it could, you know, break the bolt. These things are basically a chip, okay, and it doesn't actually have a bolt. And you can hammer nails with these things, and it's not going to go out. So
what is that called?
That's a tactical flashlight. It's an LED. It's an LED flashlight. It's also good to blind your perpetrator. Well, the photographer. All right, again, you want to discuss the plan with everybody in the house so that everybody knows. I mean, just like a fire plan, all right? You have a personal safety plan so that everybody in the house knows what they need to do, all right? A good place to have your safe room is usually, if you have children in the house, the youngest child's bedroom, all right? Because it's a lot easier for the adults to go to the kids than it is for the kids to come to the adults, okay? And usually the adults are the first ones that know that there's something that's going on and you need to take action. All right, your safe room should have a solid wood door.
Question.
Yep.
Is it important that the safe room have a room with a lock on it? I mean, most of your interior locks can easily be broken off anyway.
Yes. You should have a single or double cylinder deadbolt.
On your safe room door. I have lots of kids, and I'm thinking I don't want a deadbolt on my child's room because they'll lock himself.
Right. That's why you would put a double cylinder deadbolt on the door so that you can open it with the key on the other side.
Yeah. Well, then he can't lock it either without having the key.
Right.
So yeah.
But that is one thing. You do want to keep the key in the lock on the other side of the door so that you can lock it quickly.
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody hear me okay?
Yep.
All right, good.
There is one other thing. It's like putting a deadbolt on your door if you're in your safe room.
Yeah.
You want to be able to defend it. If you happen to be a person that defends himself with some kind of firearm, you want to be able to be in a tactical position on the outside to defend your family behind it. And you can't do that through a closed door. But if you can't defend yourself, then that
well, the only time you're going to defend yourself with a firearm is if that door opens. Okay, you're not going to, like, there are some instructors around here that actually say shoot through the door. Absolutely not. You do not want to shoot through the door. The only time you're going to fire is when that door opens and you've identified your target and you know it's someone who's trying to kill you. That's when you're going to fire. Okay, not through the door.
I'm talking about being in the doorway.
No, you don't want to be in front of the door. You do want to take up a tactical position, and we're going to go over that.
they have to come down one hallway, so.
Yeah, we're going to go over some sample layouts, okay, and again show you what we're talking about, what's going on. All right, Again, your door should have a single, a double cylinder deadbolt, depending on if you have children and you're worried about them locking themselves into their room. If so, then you're going to use a double cylinder. Having a door scope or a pee hole.
Wow!
Okay. A peephole. Whoa. Okay. Strike that from the video, eh? Hinges should be on the inside. Right, so that they just can't pop the hinges off and remove the door. Quick access for all occupants, and again, that's looking at the layout of your home so that, you know, everybody has a quick access. You might actually, depending on how your house is laid out, you might actually have two safe rooms. So, and it's looking at the, you know, how big your house is. Having a safety sticker on the window is a good idea so that when the police do arrive, they know what room you're in the house, okay? That tells them, you know, when you dial 911, you tell them that we're in the room in the back of the house and it has a state, you know, some kind of sticker on it, all right? using your verbal commands. Someone's in your house most of the time. 95% of these things could be diffused just by saying, I have a gun, I will protect myself. Right? I hear that, I'm gone. Right? So use your verbal commands. Let them know you're in the house. Right? And again, you know, 95% of the times they're gonna take off because they know you know now. And you're on the phone, you know, police are on their way. Tell them what's going on. So, all right, so let's take a look at a typical home. They hear something downstairs, and they think someone's broken into the house. So dad basically collects his firearm, and he positions himself in the hallway at the door, okay, so that he can see the stairs. His mental trigger is that if someone comes up those stairs and they're not obeying his commands, all right, he's going to fire. Okay, he needs to protect his family. Meanwhile, mom is, let's go back here. Mom is collecting the kids in this bedroom, and getting all the kids into the youngest child's room over here. All right, as soon as dad knows everybody is safe in the room, he's going to barricade himself in this room also, lock the door. All right? Mom's job is to dial 911, tell the police, you know, obviously their address, where they are and all that. Remember that cell phones. Okay? When you dial 911 on a cell phone, you're not always connecting to the same city that you live in. All right. So if you can pre-program your phone so that it actually, if it's, you know, an old cell phone, then you're going to have to dial 911. If it's a cell phone that you use on a regular basis that is activated, dial the emergency number to your local police department directly. Okay, that may save a couple of seconds. Although I hear New Hampshire, everything is going through Concord now. Is that true? Anybody know that? Yeah. Yeah.
And then the state came in with E911, took it away from the localities, and so now any 911 call in the state will be routed through Concord and then sent to whatever local police department is calling.
All right, so in New Hampshire, all 911 calls are routed through Concord automatically. So you will have to tell them, you know, your address in the city that you're in, okay? So that they can alert either, you know, Manchester PD or Londonderry or whatever it is. All right, so the only problem, anybody see a problem with this scenario here?
That everybody has to go past the stairway to get to the safe room.
Well, that's not really a problem because dad hasn't protected. The problem is that dad hasn't shot that gun in 10 years. It's been in his dresser drawer or in his lockbox for 10 years. He hasn't fired it in 10 years and he might not be all that proficient. So, essentially, he could fire a round into that safe room, all right, potentially killing one of his family, all right? So these are all things that you want to look at when you do develop your safety plan and what your, you know, what room you select, okay? Sometimes just changing the bedrooms of your youngest kid over to bedroom two might be a good idea also, all right? Same situation here, right, where mom and dad's bedroom is over here, and dad sets up with a, you know, home firearm or whatever it is, and he's protecting this stairway here. So if anybody comes up that stairway, he's got them, right? He's going to protect them. And while mom gets all the kids into the safe room, all right? That safe room is your last line of protection. And hopefully, by the time you get yourself barricaded into the safe room, the police have already arrived. Okay, they're pretty quick in New Hampshire, especially if you dial 911 and say, I have a gun and there's somebody in my house. They usually get there pretty fast. All right. Now, I know this probably goes against the grain for some people. And, you know, why should I have to barricade myself into my bedroom? Well, one, it's the best tactical move that you can do. It's much easier to protect one door than to go downstairs looking for someone who broke into your house. All right? You have no idea who's down there, how many are down there, what they have for firearms or weapons or, okay? You have to think about your family. All right? If you go downstairs hot-headed looking for someone in your house, you just may well get killed. There could be three people that overpower you or shoot you. All right? Many houses, you know, you have one way upstairs, a stairway. You go down the stairs, you usually have, you know, maybe a living room on this side, a hallway on this side. You have no idea what side they are. All right? So by barricading yourself into a safe room, you have the tactical advantage in your own home. All right? And you have to think all of these things through. All right, so let's say I go downstairs and I do see somebody in my house and I shoot him. His buddy's behind me, kills me. Where does that leave your family? Up here. Probably almost certain death, because if they've taken one life, they're going to take the rest. Right? They don't want witnesses. Right? If it comes to that level, right, it's bad news. Now, the other thing that you have to think about, all right, so you go downstairs and you shoot a 17-year-old kid trying to steal your DVR. How are you going to feel? Okay? Is that $45 DVR worth it to kill, you know, maybe the neighbor's kid trying to steal your DVR? You know, who was unarmed, maybe? All right? So you got to think about your actions all the way through everything, right? And again, situations where that has happened, the homeowner actually ended up committing suicide because he could not live with himself. You also have to live with your family and your friends, all right? So you shot a 17-year-old kid. Big deal, all right? Yeah. So, again, got to think the course through, all the way through. Yeah.
Not long ago, there was an incident where next-door neighbor woman ran to her neighbor, said somebody who had broken into her house with a weapon was wearing a mask. The neighbor grabbed his weapon, ran across, confronted the person. The person didn't put the weapon down, killed the person, took the mask off, and it was his son.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. But, you know, accidents like that do happen, right? And that's one reason why we tell you not to shoot through that door, because it could be a college kid coming home trying to surprise you. He doesn't know you bought a gun while he was at college, okay? And here you are in your safe room, and you shoot through the door and kill your son. That has happened, all right? And again, that's why you always want to verify your target. If you do have someone in your house with a mask, and they do have a weapon, and they're trying to kill you, yeah, I would shoot. Okay? Why would your son be doing something like that to begin with? Especially if they were trying, you know, to hurt you. So, and it's happened that, you know, kids have murdered their parents for, you know. Oh, that's a whole nother different story. All right. Another good thing is having a home security audit done, and I do that. My company does that. There are a lot of companies out there that will go in, check your home for you know, safety, doors, windows, locks, all that good stuff, and make suggestions. All right, our checklist is basically about 14 pages, and it's very nitty gritty. In fact, portion of it is on my website. If you want to go there, you can, you know, use that checklist and go through your house and check everything. All right, so physical security. Awareness, again, being very, yeah.
Sorry, before we leave, what happens if you're in a ranch and there are no stairs and they break in the floor where everybody is?
Yeah, you have to, again, develop the plan, okay? And again, however you laid out, where they break in and all that, you have to plan it through. And, you know, sometimes the plan is not the best plan, right? Especially in a ranch, right? You know, it's preferred up and down, but because they're going to break in on the first floor, and most of the time you're sleeping on the second. Okay, ranches pose a whole different tactical problem. But anytime you can, it again is, you know, creating a safe room and having some type of personal protection, you know. Preferably a firearm. Again, you know, this is, you know, not a seminar to toot firearms, but firearms are the number one personal protection device. It's undisputed. Okay. So, did that kind of answer your question?
Yeah.
I mean, you really have to look out, you know, look at the layout of your home and develop and think of all the different scenarios that can happen. You know, if he comes in this window, if he comes in this door. All right. So, any other questions? All right. So, physical security, and obviously the number one thing there is awareness. Okay. Always keeping track of the people around you. In fact, I usually have about a 30-foot bubble that I keep track of everybody in my bubble. Okay, because 30 feet, you know, not getting into the firearms thing, but the tool or drill of basically someone running at you, you have, within 21 feet, you really don't have time to react to a situation. So I send it out to at least 30 feet so that I know. And I watch everybody within my bubble, even behind me. All right, I make sure, and you should make sure. You know, don't be, you know, burying your head in cell phones and having the earbuds in your ears because you're just not aware of what's going on around you. Intuition. Listen to it, right? Because usually your instincts are right. Right. If you see someone or you see something that just doesn't feel right, doesn't look right, it probably usually isn't. Okay? Your instincts are really good at, you know, keeping you safe, and that's what it's designed for. Again, keeping a mindset to always prevail. All right, have a defensive mindset, saying I am going to win any situation that I get into. All right, those are the three steps that really will help you not to become a victim. And set your personal boundaries, okay? When you're out in the world, you know, you have, you know, some people call it an aura or whatever, right? If people step into your personal boundaries, don't be afraid to tell them that, hey, can you just back it up a little bit, right? If you need to, be more forceful, okay? You have to set your personal boundaries. All right, so we're going to talk a little about ATM skimming. And I don't know how many people saw it, but they just broke up a crowd in California that was doing this exact same thing with gas pumps and ATMs, all right? And what they do is they put a hidden camera up here, and believe me, these people are good, all right? They know exactly what they're doing, all right? They look like, these ATMs look like they were made by a boy. They put a fake keypad, which records your PIN number over the original keypad, and they have a scanner that goes over the where you put your card in. All right, so those three things right there, they just collect cards and PIN numbers, cards and PIN numbers. This crowd that they just arrested in California stole millions and millions and millions of dollars this way. Okay. They also do this to gas pumps, all right? Because, you know, most gas pumps, put your card in, take it out. Great. So, be careful of ATMs, where you go. Best to go right to the bank, okay? Because criminals are brazen, but I haven't seen them actually do the ones at banks, okay? And, you know, be aware that, you know, look for strange things on the ATM because, you know, it's your money, you know? And these cards, you know,
I just debit cards. I actually had an experience in Florida. I was down on vacation and had just gone to a gas station, went to the hotel that night. Following morning, I got a call from the credit card company saying in California, somebody had gone to four different Walmarts within the space of an hour and a half and racked up between $250 and $300. $300 at Walmart is the point in time where they require physical identification in addition to the credit card, and as long as they stayed under the $300 limit, they only had to present the credit card. But it was within 12 hours or so essentially, of when they had taken the card from one coast, transferred the information to California, and were using it.
Yeah, credit card companies are pretty good about that, looking for, you know, but these debit cards that are attached to your personal bank accounts, not so much. All right, and most of the time, credit cards, you're only liable for usually, what, $50? Where on these debit cards, if they clean out your bank account, it's your tough, you know? Yeah.
I got a video a while back that some of these credit cards now have chips in them. And people
yes.
can go cash your wallet, read that chip,
yeah.
and then
scanners.
Make a credit and then make a credit card out of a hotel room key and start spending it.
Yeah.
And they showed how that was happening.
Yeah, some of the new credit cards, all you gotta do is wave it and it'll you know charge your card. But these criminals are so good that they've developed these scanners that they can just walk by you and scan your credit card while it's in your wallet, okay? So if you do have a credit card like that, they do sell a metal envelope that you put your card into and then put it in your wallet, and it prevents them from scanning it, okay? Another thing with credit cards is you know, restaurants, okay? They arrested a guy in Boston where you would give him your credit card to pay for your restaurant bill, and he would go out back, scan your card, and then scan your card for real for the credit card bill, but he was collecting numbers. So it's a very, you know, disheartening world sometimes that we live in. You gotta be careful, you gotta keep your awareness going all the time. Huh? Oh yeah. Cash is good. All right, so physical security, walking, running, jogging, all right? You always want to jog against the traffic, all right? Or walk against the traffic, because you can see what's coming at you. Many abductions have taken place because they have jogged with the traffic, and you can't see a car coming up behind you, right next to you, grabbing you into the car, and they're gone, okay? And this, you know, this kind of stuff does happen, unfortunately, but taking wide curves, right? So instead of when you're taking a corner, you don't take it like this, you take a wide curve, okay? So you take it like this so that you have time to react to anything that's coming around the corner, all right? When you are out running, jogging, you know, walking, whatever, ask a friend or tell a friend where you're going and what you're doing so that they know. You're laughing back there, I can see. take different routes, right? Don't get into a habit where you're taking the same route every day at the same time, all right? Because, again, that puts you, all they're going to do is watch you for a couple of days, and they know exactly where you're going to be at what time, all right? So break it up. You know, if you take regular walks and take regular, you know, jogs, break it up so that, you know, you're not going in the same place all the time. And again, when you're jogging, I see it all the time, don't use iPods, make sure you're aware of your surroundings. All right? Using the elevators. Use them. Don't use the stairs. I'm lazy anyway, so that doesn't apply to me. What? You need the exercise, but stairs are, especially in bigger buildings, are the number one place to, you know, have situations arise, get robbed or whatever it is, okay, raped. Elevators are much safer. You do not want to press the stop button when you're in the elevator with someone who scares you, okay? If you are in an elevator with somebody who just doesn't seem right, get off of the next floor, okay? Press the button for the next floor, get off. You can always get back on the elevator later, all right? If you do get onto an elevator, if you do, you know, you're waiting for an elevator and the door opens and you see somebody that just, yeah, this doesn't look right, walk away. Wait for the next elevator, right? Because, again, if it doesn't look right, it probably isn't, right? Stand near the doors and the controls, right? So that you can press the button for the next floor if you need to get out, right? Some of these buildings, you know, 35, 50, 60, 70 floors. Well, you know, if you feel uncomfortable, don't wait till you get up to the 70th floor. Get off of the next one, okay? buses and subways. Again, wait in well-lit areas. Wait at a nearby business if you can, all right, where people are, all right, because, you know, people are your friend. Criminals look for you when you're isolated and you're alone, all right? So they don't like witnesses. Keep your personal belongings on your lap or on your feet, okay? Don't put them on the bench beside you. Put them on your lap or in between your feet so that your purse doesn't get lost or whatever it is, okay? Briefcase or, all right? And stay alert. All right, so you're coming home some night, and usually you have your front porch light on, and the light's not working. All right, this is another ploy that criminals use by, you know, taking lights out. And so, again, I suggest carrying a flashlight with you. You know, even if it's something, you know, a tactical flashlight, or even something simple like this, it's not going to show much in here. You know, just as long as you have something that you can use. I carry this flashlight religiously, day in, day out. And I cannot tell you how handy this thing comes in. Okay. So, again, criminals don't like light. So if you do come home or, you know, you live in an apartment building and the light is out, remember that that's a ploy that criminals use. Okay, so that they can attack you and witnesses have a hard time seeing it, okay? Briefcases, purses, and wallets are in. Again, you don't want to only carry the necessary items. You don't need to carry a whole lot of cash with you, all right? People who know that you carry a lot of cash, well, that's, you know, not a good thing. Some people carry fanny packs, and they carry mugger money, you know, maybe a wad of, you know, $21 bills rolled up so that they can throw and, you know, get away from the situation. Again, a lot of this is designed for, you know, places like New York City and stuff like that. This seminar goes on nationwide, so, you know, where Manchester does have a problem, a lot of this probably wouldn't apply to Manchester so much. Okay, I mean, it can happen in Manchester, but again, it's just keeping your guard up. Some people carry decoy wallets, okay, just for the fact that I can throw it and I can get away from the situation, all right? Dump it around. Grocery stores and parking lot garages, okay? Grocery stores and parking garages are the number one place for abductions, okay? So, again, be careful. Right, public restrooms, again, people have gone to the restrooms, they're sitting on the throne, and two people grab their legs and pull them right out from under, all right, and then rob them, or beat them, or whatever it is they want. Yeah?
I was always told to keep a whistle. My mother actually told me, always carry a whistle with you. There you go. Exactly.
A whistle is good, okay? And we're gonna go over all that stuff. Whistles draw attention to the situation, okay? It makes noise, okay? So anything that draws attention to your situation, whether it's, you know, a personal alarm like we have up here or whistle, will help you. Alright? And so that's, you know, these are all things that you can have in your arsenal. So laundry rooms, mailboxes, taking out the trash, okay? If you live in an apartment building, okay, a lot of times you have to, you know, take your trash out to one of the big dumpsters or go pick up your mail in a lockbox that's probably lit or, you know, semi-lit, or, right? These are all places, especially in apartment buildings, where, you know, things can happen. And you have to, you know, keep your guard up all the time. Make sure that these places are, you know, well lit. If they're not, complain to your you know, building management or whatever. All right. Security of in automobiles. All right. This is the big one. When you're walking out of the mall, all right, try to keep one arm free. All right? So that you can use this arm, usually your strong arm, so that you can, you know, defend yourself, ward people off. Maybe keep your keys in your hand. These are a very effective weapon, right? Especially if you hit them in the right place, these things hurt, right? Try to stay to well-lit areas, right? When you do go into a parking garage, look for panic or fire buttons, cameras, that kind of thing, and park near those, the call boxes, right? Criminals don't like cameras, right? So if you park near a camera, they probably will leave you alone, okay? If you park near a fire button, okay, that's a good thing to use. If you are attacked, pull the fire alarm, all right? That's, oh yeah, you know, the cops are going to show up with the fire department, all right? So they might evacuate the building, but who cares?
Yeah. There's some excellent courses out on alternative weapons, and
yep.
One of them is keys, or if you have a credit card, you can take a credit card like that, and it's almost as good as a knife to put it across somebody's throat.
They sell knives that are actually like credit cards, too.
Yeah. I'm talking about using a regular credit card.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how effective that would be, but you know, again, keep your keys in hand. When you're going into your car, go around and look inside your car. Make sure there's nobody in there waiting for you. All right? So just get into the habit of, instead of coming in this way, go around your car, look inside the passenger side, and, you know, again, small tip that can save your life. Lock your doors first thing when you get in. You know, when you first get into your car, don't check your email, your text messages, and all that. As soon as you get in your car, lock that door. All right? That'll keep you safe. Then, if you want to check your text messages, be my guest. Passengers, always look into the passenger side window. And if you do get into a situation where someone is attacking you or tries to attack you while you're, you know, at your car, then do the ring around the rosy thing. It's very hard to catch someone who's going around the car, okay? Or, as a last resort, get under the car. I don't know if you ever tried to pull anybody who was holding on to a muffler from underneath the car. It's almost virtually impossible, okay? It's very tough to pull someone from underneath the car. On my list. You're right. Look for vans that are parked next to your car, right? Because that's another abduction scheme where they'll wait near the driver's side of a woman's car, and then when she goes to unlock her car, they just pull her right into the van, and they're gone.
Well, you also though shouldn't walk between. In other words, if you're cutting through, you shouldn't walk by a van, even if not parked next to you. It doesn't matter. Don't walk by.
Good advice. I'll buy that. So, in your car, keep valuables out of sight, and do not leave paperwork in your car with your home address. Okay? Goes without saying. Note where you parked your vehicle and be observant of the immediate area when entering or exiting the vehicle. I have done this. I parked in a parking garage and couldn't for the life of remember where I parked it. What level? Yeah. Don't say it. What? Okay, I keep my registration in my wallet.
But what if somebody else uses the car?
Huh?
If somebody else uses the car, they don't have the registration.
Don't let them drive your car.
Don't you have kids?
Or if they do, give them the registration. Okay, again, it's, you know, it's a simple fix. Just give them the registration if they're borrowing your car. Be especially observant when loading the car or buckling in children. Okay, that's a good time for them to basically sneak up on you, especially when you're buckling in children. All right? Lock your vehicle. Yeah, we just said that. Leave room to maneuver when you come to a stop. All right? Especially in big cities where people will try to approach your car while you're stopped at a red light or a stop sign. All right? Leave enough room in front of your cars so that if something does happen, you have room to turn and get out of the situation, right? Don't go right up to their bumper so that now you have no room to maneuver, right? Be a courteous driver. Allow other drivers to merge. Don't tailgate. Keep off the horn and keep that middle digit to yourself, okay? You don't want to instigate a situation, all right? Again, it's common courtesy, and it will keep you safe, all right? Don't react to someone who is, you know, in the middle of road rage, right? If they're out of control, then, you know, we're going to go over that. If you are involved in a fender bender, call the police and stay in your vehicle. This is another ploy that criminals use. They have a small fender bender with you, and you get out of your car. Their friend is right on the side of the road waiting for you to get out of your car, and when you do, they jump into your car and take off. Okay? And your car is gone. So, and that's not the only thing that can happen. And there's plenty of other things as far as insurance fraud and that kind of thing, right? So you do want to stay in your car until the police arrive and stay safe. Dealing with breakdowns, keep a gas tank at least half full, always. Okay, you never know when you're gonna need it. Always have a map or a GPS in your car. I haven't seen too many maps lately, but GPS is always a good idea. Did you hear that, brother? Sorry. If you do break down, and you know you're a woman alone, and sit in the passenger seat. Right? Someone comes up, tries to help you, tell them. You know, the police are gonna be here shortly. And my husband, who is driving, is, you know, up the road. Right? So that tells them two things. Right? The police are gonna be there soon, and your husband could come back at any time. Right? It makes you look like you're not alone. Right? This is a great thing to have in your car, especially for women who don't know how to change flats, okay? And fix a flat, all right? This will pump up your flat in no time and get you back on the road so that you can at least get to a service station to take care of your flat. So, $7 can, again, could save your life. Don't stop near curbs. Even when, you know, police are stopping you, curves are bad because, you know, people, the redneckers that try to see everything that's going on, they could potentially crash into you. Sit in the front passenger seat while waiting for help. Again, if you're alone, it makes you look like, you know, like your husband is, you know, in the bushes. use emergency flashes. Try to get off the road a little bit so that, I mean, you still can be seen, but you know you don't get hit by oncoming cars. Right? And I'm sure everybody in here has seen videos where even the cop car is parked behind you, and this guy comes along and barricades into both of you. It happens all the time. So keep your doors locked, keep your windows rolled up. And again, police should arrive momentarily. Be aware of ploys that, you know, someone drives up beside you and, you know, they're pointing like this. You have a flat tire or something like that to get you to pull over. All right? That happens all the time also. All right? So be suspicious when, you know, that kind of thing happens. Or they'll say someone needs help and they want you to go with them or give you a ride there. Keep a locked in gas tank or a locked hinge gas tank cover, all right? Because there are materials where they can put into your gas tank to disable you within, you know, within a couple of miles after you leave work or whatever it is. The sugar thing, which is a fallacy, does not work, all right? Sugar does not dissolve in gasoline, so again, that's a fallacy. The worst thing that sugar would do is basically gum up your fuel injector or your fuel filter, okay, which would stop the gas leak. But it's not going to destroy your engine by, you know, gumming it up. Right? You will have to get your gas tank taken out and all that sugar removed, but... All right, so, accidents of police cars. Stay in your car with the doors locked, right? You do not have to get out of the car when a cop stops you, okay? You might have to... Yeah, I know what you're going to say, Barbara. I know. Possibly lower your window to talk to the police officer or whatever it is. If you feel uncomfortable with the officer, dial 911. I know what you're saying. This doesn't make any sense. I'm going to dial 911 with a cop, okay? There are people who pretend they are cops. Senator Brown in Massachusetts, his brother just got arrested for doing that exact same thing, okay? His brother had all kinds of police gear and badges and everything else pretending he was a police officer, okay? And that happens all the time. Just because they say they're a cop, they have a badge, doesn't mean they are a cop.
What's the problem, officer?
Exactly. Or record it. But again, if you're uncomfortable, dial 911 and tell them that, you know, I have a police officer here who says he's, you know, and I don't feel comfortable. Right? Can I request another officer? Perfectly within your right to do that.
You also don't have to stop.
I haven't tried that one. Yes, that's true. Everybody get that? When a police officer does, you can, you know, drive to a place where you feel more comfortable, with that is well lit, within reason. You know, if it's 25 miles, then that might be a problem. So, never pick up hitchhikers, obviously. Even casual acquaintances. Remember, okay, 80% of rapes are done by people you know or are acquainted with, okay? Yeah, they might give you the finger as you go by, but that's tough. It's your personal safety, right? I don't know you that well. I'm not picking you up.
So I can't pick John up if I see him on the side of the road?
No. I like to see you try to pick John up. That would be good. Anyway, road rage. Give the right away. All right. Don't play into their ploys. Okay. Don't react to road rage. Basically ignore them, okay? If it does get out of hand, dial 911, tell them what's going on, right? Tell them where you are, what your license plate number is, all that good stuff, and tell them, you know, I need you here, right? So, steering wheel locks, when you are away from your vehicle, car alarms is also a good idea. I think most cars come with alarms now. Kill switches is also another good idea if you want to prevent your car from being stolen. Vehicle tracker devices, what's that service?
Load jack.
Yeah. So those are all good devices. I don't know why this is actually in this seminar, but self-service gas pumps, another ploy. Okay, where you go and you drive up to the pump, you get out of your car. Most people leave their keys in the ignition and go around and pump their gas. Someone jumps into your car, starts it up, walks away, and you're sitting there with a gas pump in your hand. So, again, if you do that, take the keys out of your ignition and take them with you. Yeah.
They're actually doing something called sliding now. They'll pull up next to a car with a lady's fueling up, slide out of the car next to it, creep along the ground and open the passenger door and reach in and grab the pocketbook that she's inevitably left on the passenger seat.
Really?
That's something that you want to be aware of.
I haven't heard that one.
My wife always has her pocketbook on the passenger seat. But when you get out of your car, the passenger
So when you get out of your car to pump your gas, lock your doors too. If you do have a problem with, you know, you're at a stoplight, someone's getting into your car, drive away. Okay, obviously look both ways before you go, but there is a law on the books where you can break any law on the books, okay, as long as it protects your life, okay, or somebody else's, all right? So it's perfectly legal to go through a red light if it's going to help you, okay? Your personal safety, all right? That's why, you know, when you're driving your pregnant wife to the hospital, you can speed, right? And the cops probably won't you know, give you a ticket because you are getting her to the hospital because she needs medical attention, right? So, stage accidents. Again, don't leave your car. There's all kinds of ploys out there where they'll try to get you to stop by staging an accident and, again, playing on your sympathies, you know, I just want to help, okay? Maybe you're a nurse or something like that, right? Best to be a good witness and dial 911 than to, you know, get into some of these situations. If you do get carjacked, last resort is crash your car. Yeah, you might sustain some injuries, but you're going to be much better off than going to the place where this guy wants to bring you, okay? If you get into a situation where you are carjacked, if you get to the destination, it's not going to end well, all right? Someone who abducts you, they're abducting you for a reason, and it's usually not good. So you're much better off crashing your car. All right, travel security, luggage tags. All right, everybody, you know, they go up. I'm just the same way. I go to Jamaica or whatever it is, and I have my luggage tags. I have my home address on them and all that. Don't do that, right? Put your business address or put your mail stop, okay? UPS, you know, mailbox or whatever, right? So that people who do, you know, may steal your luggage don't know where you live, okay? When you do pack light, all right? Don't pack any valuables that you don't absolutely need on your vacation. Make an inventory of what's in your bags. When you go to the ticket counter, okay, make sure that you actually see your bags going on the conveyor belt down, okay, so that you're insured that it's going to get to the plane and it's not going to be tampered with, all right? People have used baggage for many years, but they'll slip something into your bag so that if it does get caught, you take the rap, okay, and then get you at the other end, all right? So you always want to maintain your luggage so that you know what's in there and nobody is slipping something into your luggage.
How many times a watch have I cut off my bags by NSA?
From TSA, yeah.
Yeah.
I travel with firearms, I know. Yeah, the world has changed. There's no doubt about that. Okay, and even Bob was saying when we were talking about police stops, not opening the door or the window, okay? Again, it's all your rights, but police are really overstepping their bounds nowadays, all over the country. And it's rampant. All right, so you do have to be careful.
Literally every time I've had a watch cut off. Yeah. Literally, every time.
All right, when you're out and on vacation, you don't want to be identified as a tourist. All right, so get rid of those Hawaiian shirts. All right, even cameras. Okay, I mean cameras are good, but you can buy cameras now that are so good that you fit in your pocket. You don't have to look like a tourist. Okay. That just attracts attention, all right? If you're gonna rent a car, taxi, private hire, or whatever it is, ask the hotel where you're staying of a good reputable company, okay? Because you might get, you know, Juan and his brother showing up, all right? You want to make sure that you have a good reputable company, or if you, you know, rent a car, make sure you bring a GPS with you, all right? Great idea, you don't have to rent it from the rental company. And it ensures that you're going to get where you're going in the shortest distance. Okay. I love GPS. I mean, they're great. the hotel that you're going to stay at, right? Give them a call ahead of time. Ask them what kind of doors they have. What kind of, if they have door viewers, okay? If they still have old key locks, right? A lot of these, you know, third world countries, depending on where you're going, don't have, you know, the security locks like the new hotels. So ask, you know, give them a call and ask them. Ask them, make sure that you don't want a room above the 10th floor. And The simple reason for that is that fire departments, their ladder trucks, do not go above the 10th floor. All right? Ask them if they have a security staff on, you know, on the premises. A lot of hotels don't. A lot of them do, and that's a good, you know, that's a good thing. Will they give your name and room number to somebody who just calls? Don't want that. Be aware of room entry ploys. Happens all the time, all right? They use a hotel phone downstairs in the lobby, dial your room number, standing. It was sending somebody up to check your air conditioning or something like that, okay? Well, it's coming from a hotel phone, you think it's legit, all right? Always dial down to the front desk and make sure you verify that situations like that, okay? They have every trick in the book when it comes to entry ploys into hotel rooms, okay? Setting you up a free complimentary dessert, okay? All kinds of things. Now this little guy right here is a great travel companion, which is just an alarm that you would put in front of a hotel door, and once you activate it, just by the door going over it, it goes off. All right, that keeps you safe because you never know who has access to your door. Just about everybody in the hotel staff has access to almost every room in a lot of hotels. So keep them honest. Now this is the door, the reverse peephole viewer that I was telling you about. You can buy it for $40 right on the internet. Okay? So you go up to a hotel room door, use the little peephole, and you can see everything that's in the room. Alright? So yeah, it is a good idea if you're traveling. Take a little piece of tape, put it over that peephole. That way it ensures that nobody's watching you. Alright. You don't want to carry excessive cash. That's just silly. You don't need to carry thousands of dollars with you when you're on vacation. Take a translation dictionary and map, or GPS is even better, so that if you do take a taxi, you know that he's taking you around three times around the city, right? And they do that, right? They rack up their meters. So GPS will prevent that. Do your research, all right? Get familiar with the culture, the laws, the crime stats, emergency numbers, the phone system, because not all phone systems are like in the U.S., okay? Get familiar with the country, all right? Because doing some things in this culture, when you go overseas, might be illegal, okay? So you want to get familiar with the laws, the culture, and what you should expect when you're there. Last thing you want to be is in a jail in a third world country. All right, and don't forget, back home, obviously you want people to pick up your mail while you're gone, or notify the post office so that they stop delivering, tell them how long they're gone. All right. Have someone come and check your home every once in a while, even maybe park a car in your driveway. Maybe your neighbor will park his car in your driveway a couple nights. All right. Remove newspapers, circulars from the front door. Get your timers all programmed so that it looks like somebody's home. All right. Lights are coming on. Had a good suggestion over here about plugging radios into timers so that, it's making noise. Make sure you notify your alarm company, right? So that the monitoring company that you use knows you're on vacation. So if they do get any type of alarm, they know to call the police right away, right? Telephone security, answering machines. Oh yes. All right. I don't know how many times I've called people and said, "Well, we're out of town until Friday. You can try us after that." All right. It's even better if you put it on Facebook. Yes, true. Yes. So don't do that. All right? All you need is a short message. You reach so-and-so. You don't even have to say your name. Okay? You reach this number. We'll get back to you when we can. That's all you need, right? Little information as possible. Cellular and wireless phones are not always private, okay? Snooping on these things is real easy, and it's very cheap. Okay, you can be surprised what you can buy on the internet. So, don't talk about financial situations. Don't give your credit card out over the phone ever. Cellular, landline, or wireless, okay? The 911 and cell phones, remember that 911, I guess in New Hampshire doesn't matter anymore because it all goes through Concord, but people in Iowa may not be so lucky where they dial 911, they might get the town, depending on what tower they're connected to, they might get a different town. So you always want to make sure that you know where you're connected to. Don't put up with abusive phone calls, pranks, obscene, threatening. Always report those. Always keep a log of when and who, if you know, calls and what they said. Okay? That way you have a history. Okay? Stalking is sometimes very hard to prove, and the more information you have, the better. Okay? You're a state rep.
I get a lot of calls.
Oh, okay.
Well, yeah, different.
Different. Yes, sir. Oh.
If you're out of town, you can pick up your messages remotely and return the calls so that you give the impression that you're, right on top of
it. Good idea. You're on vacation, and, check your messages and return the calls, even if you're on vacation.
Yeah. I forward my house phone to my cell phone.
Yeah, call forwarded. Great invention. I use it sometimes. And that goes right into the optional phone services, call forwarding, call waiting, and caller ID. All great services that you can use to your advantage. However, keep in mind that caller ID can be spoofed, okay? You might get a call, and it might say, your financial agency or whatever it is, okay? Doesn't necessarily mean that's who is calling, okay? If someone knows that you bank with Bank of America, they can easily spoof the caller ID. All right, so keep that in mind. Your bank is never going to call you and ask you for a credit card number or send you an email saying that you need to verify your account or anything like that. So try to keep telemarketers and bill collectors in check. Again, I don't care who it is. Telemarketers or bill collectors, don't give information over the phone, especially financial information. Bad news. Because you might find your savings account cleared out, or your credit card charged to, if you've got a limit of $25,000, you might be right at your limit. So these are all sites that you can use for information. There's direct marketing service. They have a telemarketer opt-out. Okay, I'm not really sure how well it works. Okay? I'm not sure the telemarketers actually obey the laws that they're supposed to. More information at consumer.gov, no fraud, all right? There they'll tell you a lot more about different telemarketer frauds that, just get information and use your information for identity theft or, trying to get information as far as credit card numbers and stuff like that. Best thing to do is just don't give any information over the phone. If I owe you money, send me a bill in the mail. All right. So identity theft. Again, mail. Mail left in your mailbox is a huge place where they get information. All right. So try to lock up your mail. Use a mail service or whatever you want. Receipts. These people will go through your trash looking for receipts, looking for information that you have thrown away. So anything that you have that has any information about you, make sure that you either shred it or burn it or rip it up into as many pieces as you want, because it could fall into the wrong hands. All right? You want to keep your personal identification personal. All right? Big one is Facebook. And we're going to talk a little bit about Facebook after, but I cannot believe the information that's available on Facebook. Debit and check cards and pins and passwords. Obviously, this goes without saying, keep your pin numbers and personal information private. Trash versus shredders. We just went over that. I would suggest a company like LifeLock, okay, which basically checks your credit bureau ratings all the time looking for fraud. You can also do this yourself and subscribe to the actual credit unions, credit bureaus, not credit unions, the credit bureaus, so that you can go in, log in, and check your credit ratings on a regular basis, okay? And I highly suggest do that, because identity theft happens very fast. They will, you know, rack up all kinds of bills in your name before you even realize what's going on, all right? So always, you know, keep track of your credit bureau ratings. Be aware of demand draft and e-checks, right? Demand drafts and e-checks do not require your signature, right? So you give somebody a personal check, and that personal check has your router number, it has your bank account number, it has your address, it has your name, everything they need to basically empty your credit, your account. All right. I set one up last week for a company that wanted to take e-checks. Believe me, I couldn't believe how easy it was. All right. Now again, all of this is traceable, but if that trace goes to a bank account in Nigeria, your money's gone. You're not getting it back, because, you know, FBI is not going to Nigeria to get your money back, okay? So you've got to be really careful as far as who you give checks to and, you know, that kind of thing. Fraudulent deposit slips. Another ploy that the criminals did was they had deposit slips printed out with their account number on it. And they walked into the bank, put the deposit slips into the deposit slip thing so that everybody was using their, you know, the deposit slips and depositing everything into their account. So what if you do, you know, go into the bank and use the deposit slips there, watch. Okay? Make sure it doesn't already have an account number on it. I highly suggest having a virtual credit card, which is a credit card that is basically designed to, you know, only do $200 or whatever it is. And I'll use those kind of cards for making purchases on the internet so that I'm not using my debit card, you know, that could potentially, you know, clean up my bank account. And I own an IT company also, and I am always battling hackers that are trying to hack sites, okay? And they're trying to hack sites to get credit card numbers, for one, and other reason, obviously, but use strong passwords, especially for online banking and that, right? For especially the financial stuff, use strong passwords. Yeah, I know they're a pain, but again, it's your money, okay? Social media, chat, be careful what you put on Facebook, okay? And I tell this to my wife all the time, all right? The electronic stuff, you know, like checking in at, oh, we're having dinner at the Yard restaurant. I'm with my husband. All right, so just tell everybody that we're not home. And she does it all the time, okay? So, you know, you've got to be really careful, because the internet is a predator's dream come true, all right? All they're going to do is friend you, and wow, they've got so much of your information already, all right? So make sure that you go through your settings on Facebook and make sure that all your private information stays private, okay? And be careful what you post on Facebook, all right? You know, we're going on vacation for a week, we won't be home, come steal my stuff. Essentially what you're saying, okay? Another thing that they do is they check the local newspapers to see who's having a week, right? Friend of ours, her mother died, and they put the hours and, you know, all that, and criminals read that, and while they were at the wake, they came and cleaned out their house. So, again, got to be careful, right? Only, you know, Make it information needed only purpose. Attachments, junk email or spam. Again, your bank is not going to send you an email saying you need to verify your account or something on that idea. They all you need to click here and put your password in. Right? Don't do it. Right? Bank of America, any bank will not tell you to do that. Right? Delete those emails right away. If you do get an email that is you know, seems legit, always highlight over the URL and make sure that you're actually going to the site that it says you're going to. Alright? That's another ploy that they use where, you know, it says one thing but it goes to another, a different place. Alright? Never open attachments that you're not familiar with. Okay, I had one tonight from UPS. My parcel has been stopped or something like that. I need to click here. And of course it had a virus on it. All right. So that one was probably because of the crash this morning. And again, criminals are smart. They take advantage of certain things that happen on the news. Okay. There was a UPS plane that crashed in Alabama. Was it Alabama?
Yeah.
I think it was? Yeah. So when you do purchase things on the internet, make sure you have an SSL indicator. That is a little lock at the top of your browser. It might be at the bottom. Okay, that lock ensures that you are on port 443, which is everything is encrypted to and from the site. All right, and usually this is the time that you're actually going into the banking network to get approval for your credit card. All right, So make sure that SSL indicator is there, that, you know, it says HTTPS at the top, not just HTTP. All right. I could do a 4-hour seminar just on cybersecurity. So, you know, again, a lot more information is in the book. But one place, Federal Trade Commission, that you can report fraud, where, and the IC3.gov is another place where you can report. You can report, yes, internet access to your network.
Change it to FBI Surveillance Van 7.
I just said that. But he saw the same picture I did. All right, where's my clicker?
Get it back.
Get it back. Actually, that's not a bad idea. Who said that? Okay, Macs are Unix-based. Okay, they are not susceptible to a lot of viruses that are out there. I run an IT company. I have 15 web servers, and they all run Unix, no Windows. Windows is the most unsecure platform there is. All right, again, these are all in your book, FBI.gov, FTC.gov, and the Consumer Resource Handbook, again, is going to just give you other information. Cyberstalking and cyberbullying, don't put up with it, okay? Most of the social network sites have a way to block people, right? You can download things on your phone to block phone numbers, texts, all that, right? Always report cyberstalking or cyberbullying because it could turn into something real, right? And, you know, it can happen on any one of these platforms, whether it's social media, chat rooms, classified ads, anywhere, okay? Personal appearance is really a factor in becoming a victim of a violent crime. It can happen to anyone and anywhere. Criminals look for opportunity, and they look for easy targets, okay? So, you know, the way you dress is not going to attract them, okay, like some people think. Right? The way you carry yourself out in public, the way you walk will, you know, make a difference, right? If you carry yourself with confidence, if you walk like you have a purpose, like you're in command, you probably won't become a victim, okay? So carry yourself with confidence, walk like you command, you know? Make eye contact with people you come across, okay? It's really gonna, if you go to New York, it's really gonna freak them out, okay? All right, but if you make eye contact with people that you meet, all right, that automatically tells them that you're aware, I know you're here, and, you know, I'm watching you. I know what you're doing, okay? So, again, walking like you're in command of your life will be very beneficial for you. And again, trust your instincts, all right? Your instincts are usually always right. There is safety in numbers. When in public, travel with a companion whenever possible. All right? Again, safety in numbers. Move faster than the crowd and be a people watcher. All right? Make sure you're always aware of your environment. Always be aware of your surroundings and people within your personal bubble, like I said. All right? Never go to a stranger's house alone. And if you, if you have to for some reason, make sure somebody knows that you're going there. All right? When dining out or you're out in public, don't take a seat with your back towards the door. Always keep your path of escape readily available and visible, okay? Because you never know when you need to take action and get out of a situation that you really don't want to be in.
So everybody's going to sit in the restaurant
case at
their door?
No, only the people who are aware and know to do that, all right? Most people don't, right? If I could get everybody to take a class like this, then yeah, there would be a problem. Yeah.
Just a little sideline, we are massage therapists, so we get calls a lot to go to hotels and stuff. And what we do personally is when we get to the hotel, we always call home, even if you're only calling your answering machine and you're saying, my contact is so-and-so, the room number is this. This is a number you can get a hold of me, and I will be home at exactly 11 o'clock or whatever.
Excellent idea.
Because it's always a retract then.
Yep. Good idea. All right. You might want to take some physical training. If you do, locate a place that is probably, local to you. Investigate and visit them. See if you can take a class. A lot of these places will allow you to take a free class, okay? Ask them if they teach real-world experience, okay? I mean, unless you want to become a Taekwondo master, you really just want to use it to, be able to protect yourself in case something happens, right? Again, remember that physical training has a commitment with it, all right? So, and visualization. Again, using your visualization to come up with scenarios that you may get into and what you're going to do if that type of scenario happens. All right, when you're at potties or bars, right, don't drink anything that somebody gives you. Okay, always make sure that you buy your own drinks. Okay, don't leave your drinks hanging around. Never leave your drink unattended even for a second, which is a problem in New Hampshire because per New Hampshire law, you cannot bring drinks into a restroom. Okay, so you either have to finish it before you go into the restroom or get a new one when you come back, okay? New Hampshire feels that, you might go into the restroom and give your brother or your underage brother a drink or something on that. I don't know what they're, but keep your hand over the top of your drink. Do not accept drinks from a date or anyone else. Do not leave yourself or friends alone and drunk, okay? Just, again, all common sense stuff. If you leave to all the people where you're going, if you leave, with somebody, I usually suggest doing that, but be aware of public bathrooms and clubs and bars. Again, a perfect place to get, assaulted. Okay. Be assertive. You don't need to be polite about unwanted advances, whether you're at a bar or anywhere. Okay, if you have someone that's doing unwanted advances, tell them, back off. Simple as that. Your verbal commands many times will take care of the situation, right? All right, personal alarms. There are all kinds of personal alarms out there. And you can investigate a lot of them. This one here is designed for hotel rooms or doors. You put it on a door and it senses the doorknob turning. And if it does, it goes off. This is a distance alarm. So you put one portion of it in your purse or in the other part on your person. And if your purse, for some reason, you're not paying attention, your purse is more than 10 feet away from you, the alarm goes off. So there's all kinds of little alarms like that. Okay. This one also works as a personal alarm, so if you, you know, you are walking down the street and someone is trying to mug you, you just, you're not going to pull it. You just, I don't think it has any batteries in it anyways. You just pull the pin and it's very loud, very loud. It's like 130 dBs and it will draw attention to the situation. Many times that will, your perpetrator will be gone, right? Because they don't like attention. So, you know, there's all kinds of, you know, that type of alarms out there that you can buy, which are useful, right? Some of them are multi-purpose. You can use them for doors, windows, or, you know, and they're very, very inexpensive, okay? All right, so we're going to go over pepper sprays and get into the nitty-gritty of things here. All right, pepper sprays come in various different forms, which are sprays, foams, and streams, all right? They have an instant effect, and believe me, I have been hit by pepper spray, and it hurts like hell. Huh? No, that's part of my. It was part of my training as a private investigator, fugitive recovery agent. So I had to, you know, experience the. And part of the drill was that I had to get hit with pepper spray and still handcuff my perp, which is not an easy task. Trust me. All right. You can buy them up to strengths of 18%, and of course, you know, that's what they used in class was the 18%. Okay, those are the strongest ones, and they will incapacitate you for at least 20 minutes to 60 minutes because it affects your breathing, gets into your lungs, it affects your eyes. Just opening your eyes is... mace, on the other hand, and tear gas are not really used anymore because... Police found that, well, Mace, remember, Mace is a brand, okay, it's a company, okay, so that may be pepper spray made by Mace, okay, but the original tear gas that was made by Mace was non-effective for people who were on drugs and sometimes just drunk under alcohol, so police went away from using tear gas to pepper spray because it was much more effective and it worked on everybody, okay? So, a couple things that you want to make sure is check your expiration date. Pepper spray does have, huh? There you go, pepper spray does have an expiration date. Now, advantages of this stuff is it works, okay? It works very well. You get it into the person's eyes or around their, you know, nose, mouth, right? It will affect them. Disadvantages of pepper spray is you have to be very careful. If you're using it at night when it's raining, it's probably not going to be as effective. If it's windy, you could very well, you know, spray that into the wind. If the wind is blowing towards you, right, you're going to basically disable yourself and not your attacker. Right, so you know some of the advantages and disadvantages of each. Okay, batons and coupons. Right, this is a coupon which is actually designed to go on your keychain. Right, and when you get this in your hand, it's a very effective weapon. Okay, depending on where you hit them with this, try to get, you know, bone or even the face, if you can. I mean, these things hurt, especially if it, you know, it's coming up like that. They actually have classes where you can learn to use these very effectively, right? And you can, you know, there's probably one around here. Larger batons, like police carry, are expandable. These are very effective. Only problem is, again, you've got to be in close, okay? You do have a little reach, all right? Same thing with this one, right? This, you have to be up close and personal to you, to the person who's attacking you, which is what exactly you don't want to be, right? Again, you want to get out of the situation first. Only if you don't have an option will you fight, okay? And use some of these personal protection devices. These are very effective. However, they're very heavy, right? Carry around all day. To keep it in your purse, again, access to that purse, making it accessible so that you don't have to go digging around. I know, I look at my wife and she's got these purses that look like luggage.
And
she, can't find anything in those things. So, again, making them available to you if you need it. Again, you want to drive a bone and pressure points, and remember legal issues. Again, this is illegal in Massachusetts. Okay, you cannot carry this in Massachusetts. So, and I mention that because we are so close to the border here. If you bring a lot of these devices, stun guns, tasers, pepper spray, you can be arrested in Massachusetts. New Hampshire, just about anything. You can have anything in New Hampshire, just about. Within reason. I said that for you. All right. So, whistles. Again, whistles are not a bad thing to have, all right? Again, they bring attention to the situation. They make noise and they, they bring attention. Stun guns. These are, and I'm going to set this off, all right, so that you can... People, when they grow up, are usually, you like that, huh? People, when they grow up, are usually afraid of the same things that they were afraid of when they were kids, electricity being one of them, okay? Sometimes, all you need to do is that little spark, and they say, hey, I'm out of here. Other than that, those are really not really that effective, okay? Other than the scare factor, because, again, you've got to remember that you've got to have it on skin. You got to have it in a place where, and that's exactly the place that you don't want to be. You don't want to be that up close and personal to someone who's trying to attack you. That, to be effective, has to be on the skin for 7 to 10 seconds at least, okay, to even affect them. All right, so the scare factor is the biggest thing with the stun gun. They're great motivators for teenage kids, though. Tasers. Tasers are another option. Tasers are expensive, okay? That's one of the problems with tasers. You can buy a taser for about $300 on up, all right? Problem with tasers is they're a one-shot deal. If you're being attacked by three people, pick one, all right? 15, yeah, they have a distance, all right, so 15 feet. And the problem, another problem with tasers is that it sends out either two dots or three dots, or four dots that are connected to a wire, all right? So that wire is only so long. And if you don't get both dots into them, what have you got? Nothing, you got a plastic hammer. another problem with tasers is that clothing, heavy clothing like leather jackets and stuff like that, it will not penetrate, all right? So if you do go out and buy a taser, remember that it has limitations, right? It's a very expensive tool, and it is effective. I mean, on someone, dressed like this, it will take me down. Don't shoot him in the face. Yeah. And again, you have to worry about legal ramifications. If you overreact in a situation and you tase somebody, okay, it could come back on you, all right? So, when you are in a situation, yelling for help, okay? There's a program out there that says yell fire no matter what. Don't suggest doing that because, yeah, you'll get the fire department there, but actually yell what is going on. If you're in an alley, someone's trying to rape you, yell rape, okay? Let the people around you know what's going on. You might get lucky and have a guy like me, right, in the area. I carry a gun all the time. I'm carrying a gun right now, right?
Oh, no.
So, you just might get lucky. If you yell fire, all right, I won't know what to do. I won't know what's going on. I'm going to dial 911 and call, say the fire. I need a fire department. There's a fire over here. If you yell rape, well, I know exactly what's going on, don't I? All right? I'm in a better position to help you than if you yell fire. So I don't agree with that program. Never did, probably never will. So keys, like we discussed before, is a good, if you don't have a baton, this is a very effective weapon to deter somebody from attacking you. All right, you are far more familiar, far more likely to survive a violent assault if you defend yourself with a gun. In episodes where robbery victims were injured, the injury defense rates were resistant with a gun, only 6%. Did nothing at all, 25% were injured. Resisted with a knife, 40%. That's amazing. Okay? If you have a knife, you would think that it would protect you. But many times that knife is taken from you and used against you. Especially if you don't know how to handle a knife correctly. Right? Non-violent resistance, which is basically verbal commands, right, is 45%, right, in violent situations. Right? Again, many times verbal commands will diffuse many situations, especially if it's out in public where other people can hear what's going on. You know, if you yell, you know, stay away from me, I don't want you, it, you know, advancing anymore. Okay, well, it tells everybody in the rooms, and there's a problem with this guy. All right. So, when a woman was armed with a gun or a knife, only 3% of rape attacks are completed, compared to 32% when a woman was completely unarmed. Okay, so having something is better than nothing. All right. Yeah, the gun is the ultimate personal protection device, but again, that comes with responsibilities. The firearm section is at the end of the seminar, and they do that for a reason. If people who do not want to stay for the firearm section, then you know we usually dismiss them right there. Okay. So, and we're getting very close. The Manchester of crime stats, right? Things that you, police department's not going to be happy with me. Manchester crime index is 64% higher than the rest of the state. That's huge. All right. The Hampshire crime index is an overall 15% lower than the national average. So Manchester crime index is much higher than the national average. Manchester violent crime rate is 184% higher than the rest of New Hampshire. Why do you think that is?
People from Massachusetts.
Okay. that's good. That's the first time I heard that.
We have diversity. A lot of drug dealers left Lawrence and came up here because they can do better up here.
Yeah, well, that's one reason. We are the largest city in the state. So automatically, you know, higher crime. We also have a lot of refugees in this town. Okay. Back in when Mayor Baines he made us a refugee city. So That's another reason.
Hey, Bob.
Yo!
You should expand on that a little bit. It's not so much having the refugees as it is the International Institute in New Hampshire fails to properly inform these people that things that might be otherwise legal in their home countries are illegal.
That's true. That is true. Yeah. And Manchester has a crime prevention program just like this, which nobody knows about. Okay. They only do it when it's requested. And the problem is that nobody requests it because nobody knows about it. Because I actually went into the Manchester PD and told them about this program so they could, you know, probably refer people to attend these seminars. Oh, we don't know. We have our own program. So when do you do them? Oh, only when people request them. How often do people request them? Almost never. Because they don't know about it. So anyways, I have no idea what their program is like, but the New Hampshire violent crime rate is 34% lower than the national average. The Manchester property crime rate is 54% higher than the rest of the state. Okay, property crimes, burglary, that kind of thing. Not good. The New Hampshire property crime rate is 13% lower than the national average. So, you know, again, New Hampshire is a great place to live. It's one of the safest places in the country to take up residence, just as long as you're not living in Manchester.
Right.
So, the chance of being a victim of a crime in Manchester is 1 in 23. That's huge. That's very high. Don't hit the button yet. The chance of being the victim of a violent crime in Manchester is 1 in 178. And the chance of being a victim of a property crime in Manchester is 1 in 27. So that means one person in here is going to have a burglary at some time. All right? You know, it's pretty staggering when you look at the stats. All right, module one, in the workplace. We're going to go through this quick and then do the firearm section, and we're out of here. All right, this is all, again, common sense, building security. If you work in a building that has security, know the security personnel and put them on speed dial. All right, emergency evacuation procedures. Make sure you're familiar with them. Know where the emergency exits are so in case you do have to get out of your building in an emergency, whether it be an active shooter or something on that idea, you know what to do. Okay. Oh, and the Obama administration has just put out a thing after Sandy Hook of how to deal with an active shooter.
Scissors.
No, the newest one, run and hide.
Right, and if they come face to face, then use the scissors.
Right.
Use the whistle.
Use the whistle, yeah.
You shoot
yeah.
the shotgun out the
so. When at work, keep your valuables at home. You don't have to bring in your stuff to show it off to your coworkers. Remember, again, you don't know who your coworkers are, all right? So, or what they're capable of. If you're working long hours and you work into the night, right? It's perfectly acceptable to call building security and have them walk you to your car, all right? So. Again, staying safe. Always report harassment in the workplace. Don't give out your personal information, home address, that kind of thing. Because a lot of workplace incidents end up outside the home. Right? Over 1 million assaults and threats happen annually in the workplace. Again, strangers in the workplace. You know who is supposed to be there, so you know, keep your, especially if you're working late at night. Possible warning signs, threats, irrational behavior, displays of unwanted anger or affection. Okay, these are all warning signs of individuals that you probably don't want to deal with. Inability to take criticism. You know, looking at this, I know a lot of people like this. Lack of concern for the safety of others is another one. Stalking or harassment, don't ever put up with it. Always report it, call the police. And if a co-worker shows up at your door at 9 o'clock at night, it might not be a good sign. All right? So, again, try to keep your personal information personal. Right? Co-workers don't need to know where you live. All right, and that brings us up to the firearms supplement. And if anybody who is, you know, really against firearms, at this point you can probably leave. If not, we're going to just continue on and finish up. Shoot away. All right. Most of this is, you know, just, again, all right. Correlation, whether correlation or coincidence, the trend in NICS background checks required for firearms purchases took a major leap in 2006, just after Katrina, all right, because the police and military were going around and collecting guns. Totally illegal, okay? Especially in New Hampshire. New Hampshire does have an Emergency Powers Act, and in any type of emergency, the government cannot collect your guns. If they try, I will shoot them. We do have a state law that protects us, okay? Not counting the Constitution, you know. So, you can see the trend of gun ownership is greatly increasing. That's why guys like me are really busy, right? And people are taking the initiative to take classes and learn how to use that tool properly. All right? Why people are buying guns? 40% say home defense. Because they know the police are not there to protect them. The police are basically, they show up and they do the paperwork. Everything else is your job, pretty much. Okay? So, second, personal protection. Okay, this is outside the home. That's why guys like me carry a gun all the time. And, you know, looking at the Manchester crime stats, now you can understand why. All right. 30% say target shooting and 28% hunting. 10 years ago, these stats would have been reversed. Okay? Times are changing. And, you know, there's a reason for it. So, violent crime and gun ownership trends. All right, so murder, rape, robbery, aggravated assault. You can see there is a slow downward trend because the more guns out there in the hands of private citizens, law-abiding private citizens, means less crime, okay? If you don't believe me, take a look at the crime rates in New Hampshire versus Illinois. Okay, Chicago. Chicago has more murders in one day than we have in 5 years. Yeah.
Those are national numbers, right?
Yes. Yeah, these are national numbers. So the trend of violent crime continues to drop as gun ownership and concealed carry permits continue to grow. With violent crime at a 38-year low and gun ownership and concealed carry permits at an all-time high, the argument of that more guns equals more crime is not supported by the facts. Okay, even though the anti-gunners, the Brady Bunch, and those guys will try to convince you that the more guns that we have, you know, it's just a bad thing. All right. Guns are used 2,800 times more often to protect life than they are to take them. Okay. Most of these stats are directly from the FBI. In fact, the Obama administration just had a gun survey done, and it didn't work out well for him because they came up with stats like this. And he was just looking for a reason to remove them. Guns are safer than playing football, cheerleading, driving, or bathing. Okay? If you look at the number of gun accidents versus the number of accidents that happen on a football field, guns are safer. Guns are safer than taking a bath. More people die from slipping and falling in the tub than they do by guns. Right? You are 2.5 times more likely to foil a criminal attack with a gun than any other weapon. 2.5 times. That's in your favor. Right? Guns prevent an estimated 2.5 million crimes a year and or 6,849 per day. Less than 1% are ever fired. So, most of the time, all you're going to do is show that firearm, and it diffuses the situation, okay? Rape is 25% higher in non-carry states. New Hampshire is a carry state, right? Almost anybody can carry a gun if they can pass the criminal background check. States like Illinois, where they do now, the Supreme Court just told them they had to come up with a carry, you know, it means for their citizens to carry guns, where they have fought it tooth and nail, and they still are. Okay, but if you look at the stats between, you know, carry states and non-carry states, I'd rather live in a place like New Hampshire. Right, every day, 550 rapes, 1,100 murders, and 5,200 other violent crimes are prevented just by showing the gun. Right, doesn't even have to be loaded. Just show it to them. 90% of all violent crimes in the U.S. do not involve firearms of any type, okay? Because criminals know if they carry a firearm, the consequences go up. That means more years in prison, okay? Crimes where the offender possessed the gun, 83% do not use or threaten to use the gun because of that same reason. They know if the gun is involved, it involves more time in prison. Two-thirds of the people who die each year from gunfire are criminals being shot by other criminals. That's too bad. and 94.4 of gun murders are gang-related, okay? That's why Illinois has such a problem. There are many gangs, Los Angeles, Detroit, big cities like that have a major problem with gangs. And that's where, you know, most of the gun murders come from, are gang-related. The number of times per year an American uses a firearm to determine a home invasion. And a home invasion is not a specific crime. And most jurisdictions do not look at home invasion as a specific crime. It's called burglary most of the time. Okay. Certain jurisdictions call a home invasion someone who breaks into your house with intent to do you physical harm. Right? Only a few states have actually come out and done that. Private citizens shoot 3 times more criminals and prevent more crime than police. Again, police only show up to do the paperwork. In actual shootings, police have an error rate of 11%. Private citizens have an error rate of only 2%. Police have a mentality of shoot first, ask questions later. Okay, where, you know, and they know, if they shoot somebody on the job, it's probably going to go, you know. But you, if you shoot somebody, you know, out on the street protecting your life, well, you have a lot more to go through. So you're going to be even more, you know, even more sure that when you do that, it's, you know, going to be correct. So 192,500 women per year avoid being raped because they had a gun for self-defense. That's, you know. That's huge. All right, so owning a firearm for defense of self and family. If it is absolute, you have to ask yourself some questions first, right? I don't want you to go out and buy a gun and say, hey, I've got a gun, right? You have to ask yourself first, right? If absolutely necessary, can you take the life of somebody else to protect your life, the life of your family, or somebody else? Okay? Got a guy over here? Absolutely. I'm the same way, right? But if you can't answer yes to that question, don't buy a gun, right? Because it probably will be taken from you and used against you, right? Criminals, you know, you don't have to be bright to be a criminal, but they do have instincts also. And sometimes they can tell whether you are capable of pulling that trigger or not. Can you live with yourself afterwards if you do take the life of somebody? Another question you need to ask yourself. I might need counseling anyways, but. Should you buy a pistol, a revolver, a rifle, or a shotgun?
All of the above.
All of the above, I like it. All right, I'm with her. They all have their specific uses, all right? Certified, if you do buy a gun, I highly suggest you take some instruction and training to learn how to use it properly, all right? Remember about liability and insurance. Okay, I actually carry insurance in case I shoot somebody. Yeah, I do.
How do you get it?
How do I get it? Sign it. Well, you can buy it from the NRA, and you can also buy it from the United States Concealed Carry Association. And basically, it's defense insurance. If you do shoot someone in self-defense, okay, it's very, very costly to mount a legal defense if for some reason they bring you up on criminal charges or even civil charges. Okay, if you shoot somebody, their family can bring you to court for monetary damages. So that's, you know, another thing to consider. Again, you have to, and part of the training is dealing with responsibilities and ramifications. Okay, you have to know when you can protect your life and when you can't. Right. All firearms have a specific fit and function for the purpose or the person. Right? If you're going to carry a firearm and you're tiny like my friend over there, Aaron, right? You don't want to buy a full-size Glock or something on that. So every firearm has their purpose for, you know, fit. Yeah.
Sig Arms, which is right here in Epping.
Yeah.
And it's a retired lieutenant colonel that gives it from the Marine Corps. And it's a very excellent course on how to prep yourself.
Right. And mental preparation?
You might want to make a decision to not carry a gun.
Well, that's a big part of it, is mental preparation, because under high stress conditions, All right, your mind is going through all kinds of things, and you want to make many of these decisions as possible before you do get into a situation. And that's where the visualization comes in preparing your subconscious mind to react the way you want it to. All right. If you do go out and buy a firearm, I highly suggest taking a course. All right. NRA does all kinds of courses, from home firearm safety, which is a non-shooting course, 4 hours. First step pistol, which is another 4-hour course that is a shooting course, usually designed for one-on-one or one-on-three people. Basic pistol course is a full-day course and talks about all the different pistol types, the action types, and safety, number one, of course. Any NRA course, number one thing is safety, okay? This is a shooting course, so you will go out on the range and shoot for a couple hours. Rifle course is a 2-day course, so it's a commitment to, you know. Shotgun course is, again, 2 days, but that shotgun course is mostly for sport, okay? It's about shooting birds, okay? And so it's not really a tactical home defense. NRA personal protection in the home course, these are the courses that are very hot right now. Personal protection in the home and personal protection outside the home. I've got two people back there who just went through personal protection outside the home, and he was a little tired at the end of the day. But it's an excellent course. We actually have lawyers come in, or someone who is trained to teach about the law in New Hampshire, when you can shoot, when you can't. In fact, Tom Brown was here. He did an excellent job on Sunday talking to these guys about the law and, you know, personal protection. It's not as straight and clear, you know, as you may think. So these are excellent courses. Another course is United States Concealed Carry Association, Concealed Carry and Home Defense. This is a full-day course, non-shooting, and these are all courses that I offer. Defensive pistol is another one. Educational and institutional threat management, that is dealing with an active shooter. That's more not for home defense, really. I also do private firearms instruction, if you didn't want to take a class. NRA Eddie Eagle Gun Safe Program is geared towards pre-K through third grade, and that's basically teaching children what to do if they do find a firearm. Okay, and it's an excellent program. It's been around for a long time, and most of the time it's free when we go into a first grade or a school, and you know, most schools should take advantage of it, okay? Because people have been saved from kids doing the right thing and telling their parents that they found a gun. So, and that will wrap up our program. You have my card. If you don't, there's some on the table over here. Remember that safety is not always easy or convenient, but always keep your awareness up, okay? Always make sure what's going on around you. Build your layers of protection in your home, and remember that the number one thing is to get out of any situation that you can get. Even if you are home, okay, if someone breaks into your house, you have an option to get out, get to the neighbor's house, dial 911. You know, have them dial 911. It's the best way to stay alive. And remember, you can refuse to be a victim. If you have any questions, email me, call me, or whatever it is. All right? I'm glad everybody came out tonight. Thank you.